Good morning and welcome to the 19th meeting in 2024 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. Please note that apologies have been received from Stephanie Callaghan. I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent. And the first item on our agenda today is to take evidence on the Housing Scotland Bill from two panels of witnesses. We're joined on our first panel today by Joshua Davis, who is a programme manager at Nationwide Foundation, Anna Evans, who's a director at the Indigo Housing Group, Deborah Hay, who's the senior policy advisor at Joseph Rowntree Foundation, Professor Ken Gibb, who's the director at UK Collaborative Centre for Housing Evidence at the University of Glasgow, and Professor Alex Marsh, who is the professor of public policy at the University of Bristol. And I welcome all of our witnesses to the meeting. We're going to go straight to questions. Just to let you know that there's no need for you to operate your microphones. We'll do that for you. One less thing for you to have to think about while you talk to us today. And I'm going to start with a couple of questions that are kind of overview questions. And also to say that we do have some questions that will be members will direct specifically to somebody. But in this case, I would like to hear from all of you. And basically, that would be, we'd be interested to hear a brief overview of your research work and key points that might be relevant for the consideration of the Housing Scotland Bill. And maybe we'll just start with Deborah and move that way.
Good morning and many thanks for inviting JRF today. JRF is a social change organisation which is trying to solve poverty and move to a more just and equitable future. And so consequently, we are very much on the side of solutions that will help people who are experiencing great financial difficulty at the moment. So I'm kind of here, I guess, in that regard. There's some very specific evidence that I would like to lead to the committee today, which is based on a report that we did with some colleagues that are here today back in 2022, where we asked tenants what they wanted from future private rented sector reform. So I'll be drawing on that, as well as some of the evidence that JRF has been taking over the COVID and since during the financial crisis.
Okay, thanks. And is there anything in specific that you think, just is there anything you want to just tease out at the moment, just to highlight that you...
In terms of general comments about the bill? JRF are supportive of efforts to improve the situation for low-income renters because renters have been at the sharpest end of the cost of living crisis and during the pandemic before that. So we are very keen to find solutions that will help them. A third of private rented sector tenants are in poverty and a great many more are experiencing quite considerable financial stress. So it is something that is very close to our hearts. Mm. Is that enough?
That's good. I'm sure more will come out as we ask other questions. So I'm just going to go along to Alex. Do you want to come in now and just give a bit of an overview of your research work?
Sure. Thanks very much. And thanks for the invitation to come along today. So my research is mostly about rented housing, generally both social and private rented. Within that, I've looked at a range of topics. So much of the work with Ken, but not all of it. So things like rent control and price regulation, non-price regulation in the private rented sector. We've done some work on policy transfer between countries. We had quite a pretty big, under the cash banner, we had quite a substantial programme of work looking at standards, enforcement, compliance. Did research on landlord behaviour, particularly focused on small landlords in the private rented sector. The work that Deborah referred to on the future of the private rented sector in Scotland. So within cash, of which I'm also a member and co-investigator, my role is as systems theme lead. So part of what CASH is about is thinking about housing systemically and thinking about interconnection. So I guess if I want to just highlight a couple of things, I think that would be one of them. So I think thinking about this bill within the context of what else is going on, both legislatively, but also in terms of socio-political context. So part of my work is I guess I would characterise it as socio-legal or sort of law in context. So it's saying, well, let's think about if like the legal provisions, but let's understand how they function in practice and how they interact with the market context, the social context, the cultural context in which they are embedded. And that's really important, not just in relation to thinking about current initiatives, but it's also really important in thinking about how we interpret what's going on elsewhere and what we can learn from from other contexts and other systems. So we always need to be mindful of quite how we draw the lessons and how strongly we draw the lessons. So I think that's a key part of a lot of what we've been doing. I'll stop there.
Okay, thanks very much. And just so we're all on the same page, CASH is the acronym for Collaborative Centre for Housing Evidence.
Sure, yes, yes. Sorry, apologies.
That's all right. I know that we use a lot of those things around here. It's a completely other language. Ken.
Thanks, yes. So I would just basically repeat some of the things that Alex has just said, so I won't do that. We've done a lot of work together since about 2021. It feels like 1921, but that's been really insightful. I think the rent control evidence review, which was the first thing that we did, I think has a number of important things to say. One is that the conventional wisdom, as it were, that all economists think exactly the same thing about rent controls isn't the case, and that it's much more nuanced, particularly amongst housing specialist economists. And happy to talk more about that as we go along. The other thing that comes out of all of that work is just this, the necessity to focus on good design of policy. Mm-hmm. This is a complex system where there are all manner of interactions and feedbacks and not so much unanticipated as difficult to see consequences because of the complexity of the system. And that also implies that rent control or rent regulation policy has to be complemented by parallel policies that help, so more affordable social housing, for instance, alongside the sense that that for different reasons the rental market may be shrinking, one of which may be something to do with poorly designed rent controls, for instance. The other thing is, the other bit of work that's not really cash related that I've been involved in, which is relevant, is some ongoing work, and I may have raised this before in this committee and it's still ongoing, but some work with the Urban Big Data Centre, where we're trying to kind of statistically test whether what happened in Scotland after the Act in 2016 actually led to differences compared to the rest of the UK, whether you can actually statistically find that. And we've used two different kinds of data to suggest that the rental market may actually have taken the kind of changes in the 2016 Act in its stride to some extent, just to boil it all down, and that the consequences were not either particularly damaging in the short term pre-COVID. You're only looking at 2 years, actually, but that's, I think, quite interesting work and quite unusual because it's quite econometrically robust. And there's not much of that kind of stuff going on, just because the data can be quite challenging, Anna's work accepting. So that's the main things I think I want to say. About the bill, I mean, one thing I'd say about the bill is I think that, as we've been saying all along, the rent control aspects of it still feel underdeveloped and not specified in enough detail. I think some of the subsequent regulations, etc., are going to do quite a lot of the work to fill out the blanks to some extent. So that's maybe something else we can talk about too.
Okay, great. Thanks very much for that. Anna.
Hi there, and thanks for asking me along. Our work has been funded by the Nationwide Foundation, and we've been doing research since 2019, large-scale quantitative surveys with tenants, landlords, and large-scale qualitative work with tenants and landlords as well. We've had three waves reported in 2020, 22, and we're just about to publish for 24. So it's very large-scale and insightful work about that the purpose was really to look at the impact of the private residential tenancy, but obviously with change since then, COVID legislation and cost of living legislation, we've also looked at that. And in terms of the impact of the bill, I guess our overall conclusion is that whilst the PRT in particular brings in enhanced rights for tenants, what is the most important thing is the awareness of those rights and enabling tenants to assert those rights through enforcement. In other words, legislation in itself is not enough. And the market imbalances that we see now, it's clearly a seller's market. The market is all powerful, really. And if there are not sufficient affordable alternatives, people with less economic power have less choice. So it has to be implemented with other measures, not just legislation.
Okay, thanks. Joshua.
Thank you. Good morning, committee, and thanks for inviting me here to speak with you. I'm from the Nationwide Foundation, and I programme manage our private rented sector work. The Nationwide Foundation is an independent national charity that since 2013 has been supporting, testing and evidencing solutions to the UK's housing crisis, particularly from the perspective of those most in need. And part of our work funds projects that aim to transform the private rented sector, including, as Anna's mentioned, the longitudinal Rent Better study. So I'm here today with Anna, who has led the research, but to be clear, I'm here to set out the foundation's views, and Anna's here to provide sort of that detail and background. And just in terms of our perspective, overall perspective on the bill, having a safe and secure home where we can put down roots enriches our lives and supports our health and well-being. And we believe that a system that works for both tenants and landlords is a healthy system. And we know, of course, that there are many excellent landlords out there who take providing a home seriously. But the Foundation's focus, and what we'd most like to talk about today, is on protecting those renters who are most vulnerable and those who are most at risk of being harmed by a poorly functioning PRS. And we do believe that this legislation is a positive step in the right direction to reducing the harm the system is currently inflicting on many of those individuals and their families. So while we welcome introduction of the bill, our research shows that there is much more that needs to be done, as Anna's already started to discuss with you. And fundamentally, I think this boils down to three key issues that I'd like to focus on. Firstly, much more needs to be done to support tenants to know and use their rights, as Anna's mentioned. Secondly, we must address wider challenges in the housing system, not just in the PRS. And thirdly, there are failings with existing legislation that I think need addressing. I can go into those points a little bit more detail if that's helpful. Or
let's just see if those come out in the questions that we've got, but that's very helpful. So, I mean, actually, you've kind of gone into a space that I was going to ask, so I can maybe pick that up, which is, you know, you got into quite a bit of detail around the bill there, and I would be interested to hear from others to what extent, so the intention of the bill from the Scottish Government is that it's going to bring forward a package of reforms that will help ensure that people have a safe, secure and affordable place to live. And I'd be interested to hear to what extent you think the bill as a whole delivers these aims. Maybe I'll start with Ken.
I mean, I guess the bill is a package of things which attempts to do certain things which their intention is to achieve some of those objectives. I think one of the challenges here is that although obviously a large part of housing policy is devolved in Scotland, there are important parts that aren't, and two of the really important part that isn't is the social security system and the local housing allowance. So that is always going to have a bearing on exactly how the system plays out and how reforms might play out, and as and until local housing allowance changes significantly in terms of its generosity, there's always going to be constraints, and part of the issues here is trying to sort that out, I suppose, which is a UK-wide issue. Similarly, much of the tax system that affects landlords and their decisions and their intentions are not to do with Scotland. I mean, certainly the additional dwelling supplement is obviously bigger in Scotland than it is anywhere else. But a lot of the other tax changes are in the last 10 years were from the UK government. And these things have a compounding effect on the decisions that landlords might make. So that's rather kind of something I wanted to say, which is maybe it's not quite on point exactly to what you were saying, but I think that's what I would offer.
Well, thanks for that. I mean, I think it's helpful to understand a context, and it makes me. I mean, I guess one of the things I wonder is if we had those powers, would we be designing a different bill?
Well, I think almost certainly. I think the LHA is at the heart of all of this, I think.
So we've got a kind of limiting context, and we're trying to create something to meet those needs, the safe, secure and affordable place within that. Those constraints. Yeah. Anybody else want to come in on the whether the bill delivers those aims?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, as I've already started to suggest, we think the bill's a good step, but we don't think it overall does deliver on the aims of sort of addressing all the problems in the private rented sector. It's one thing to have rights, but another thing to actually use them. Mm. And the Rent Better research has found that many renters don't know what their rights are. For example, the majority of renters did not know that the tenancy regime had changed or what type of tenancy they were on. So we believe we need a programme of work to support to promote renters' rights by providing information, advice and support. And at the same time, even when renters do know their rights, they struggle to access enforcement. One of the striking pieces of statistics that jumped out for me from the research was that of the 1,000 renters interviewed, only 10 renters, not 10%, but literally 10, had ever contacted their local authority enforcement teams. So there's just no access to those teams or even maybe an awareness that they exist. And local authorities simply don't have the resources to enforce properly. And without sufficient resources, any changes to tenancy law risk being ineffective, as landlords will have no incentive to operate within the law. And I don't know if you wanted to give me more detail on that.
I think what I would add is I don't think this bill in itself can deliver on safe, secure and affordable. It has to be seen in the round with other legislation that Scottish Government and Scottish Parliament has implemented in the past or passed in the past. And also it has to be seen in the context of the market. This is a private rented market. And as I said earlier, the imbalance that currently exists in terms of supply and demand and decreasing affordability really challenges safety, security and affordability because if people don't have choice and know that they can't get something at a similar rent that they're what they're renting at the moment of the similar quality, size and type that they need, it means that tenants don't challenge. And we've found that throughout since 2019, especially those with less economic power or power in the market. It's just not worth it. It's seen as too much hassle, time, cost. People perceive that there would be cost in challenge. And if there is no alternative, they just put up with what they've got at the moment. So, as I said at the beginning, I think the most important thing is strong measures of enforcement to enforce what currently exists so that people can exercise their rights.
Okay, thanks. Deborah.
Just building on those answers, happily agree with all of that, and that certainly echoes the research that we did in 2022 as well, particularly for low-income tenants. They had less choice, they were much more constrained, they were much more fearful about taking action. There was a certain amount of sort of learned helplessness at the bottom of the market about what they could do. And we still have a regime that requires tenants to raise their concerns about rent increases. And it would be useful, I think, when we get to the stage of sort of further design, whether there are ways in which we can put the onus on landlords to ensure compliance rather than asking tenants to raise individual queries. So if you've got a clear idea about the kind of private rented sector that we want, let's design it that way. Let's be incredibly clear about it for both tenants and landlords, and let's ensure that the compliance lies with landlords and the kind of enforcement that Anna is talking about, rather than relying on individual, quite fearful tenants to raise those concerns, because they just won't.
Thanks. Alex, anything to add?
I think I'd absolutely endorse that point about switching. I said sometimes we characterise that as switching from ex post quality control to sort of quality assurance. It's not for the tenant to come in and remediate the problem. The landlord should be understanding what the benchmark is that is expected and start there, if you see what I mean. I think the other thing I would just add is, going back to this point about placing the relationship, it is a relationship between landlord and tenant. And if we strengthen rights, that's important. If we make sure information is available, that's important. But I think one thing to bear in mind also is it's a social relationship. So we can sort of engineer a situation where the tenant can stay, but if they've raised a complaint, even if the landlord's been advised to sort the problem, they've still got to deal with that person on an ongoing basis. So actually there's a sort of irreducible social component to that. It might well be, I know my rights, I know where to go, but I'm still not going to do it because actually I've got to live here with this person as my landlord. So there is a component of that which is sort of integral to this. That's why it's law, but also understanding the dynamics of that as a relationship in many cases, particularly for smaller landlords, not so much for corporate landlords, but maybe that's not where the problems lie in quite the same way for some of these quality issues. Stop there.
Okay. I've got a supplementary on that, actually, inspired, which is that the committee is keeping an eye on petition 1778, which is around the landlord register scheme. And in that petition, petitioner stated that the scheme is not fit for purpose, that there's no scrutiny of whether an applicant is a fit and proper person, and then went on to explain that there's no checks carried out by any relevant authority, for example, whether the landlord is in possession of an up-to-date gas safety certificate for the property, unless a lack of proper documentation is brought to the attention of the local authority. And I'd be interested if any of you think that that could be a helpful element. It's not in the bill, but could it be a helpful element to try to address the fit and proper person aspect? Deborah, you're nodding a bit, so I'm going to go to you.
I think tenants were very clear with us in our study that they wanted to see much greater focus on landlords coming forward with that kind of information. And although this might not be how we might design the policy, the kinds of things that they wanted was the equivalent of a house report, but for a tenancy. So that idea about being able to look online and discover that the certification is up to date, the landlord has been vetted, what the rent was. They wanted to have a much more sort of open and transparent system of information, which I thought was really interesting. But again, sort of spanning out a bit, I think one of the themes, certainly in the submissions that I read, and certainly talking to colleagues, is local authority capacity to do this. So, at the risk of teaching grannies to suck eggs, and forgive me, simply giving people a duty to do something doesn't make it happen. So local authorities have huge amounts of asks on them at the moment. You will be all very, very well aware of that. We have to find a way of resourcing this. And there's a whole set of sort of data and enforcement and duties that it would be useful to sort of look at in the round for local authorities so that they have all of the levers that they need to really design a local housing system that works for people, not just this one little bit. That might be slightly out with the scope of today's discussions, but I do think it's important. We've got a whole heap of things running: short-term lets, the private rented sector reform, the affordable housing supply programme, standards, you know, and so on and so forth. And we're adding into this in this bill that they should do all of the groundwork in terms of understanding what rents are being charged in their local area and what is happening. I think there would be enormous value in gathering that data in some way. I'll leave it to my research colleagues to tell us what the best way of doing that is, but they need to have the capacity to do it if we are to make progress.
Okay. Yeah, and we've got a couple of questions later on data, so we'll come to that in more detail. Alex.
Thanks. Yes. So on that point about registration and licensing, and just thinking about, I mean, the data or the information challenge is difficult for tenants, particularly for landlords. Just as a small example of things that make a difference. So obviously, in relation to the system here, you know, landlords sort of self-certifying as being compliant with a sort of single tick box. When that system was swapped to sort of itemising the various dimensions of what compliance actually meant, certainly we talked to local authorities who said, suddenly we were getting landlords identifying themselves as not fully compliant who previously sort of had been. So it's simply sort of raising awareness through the box that you have to tick made a difference to landlords. That's what I'm supposed to be doing, you know. Picking up on dimensions of compliance that way. So awareness raising on that side as well. I mean, I realise there's a system to professionalise landlords sort of generally, but we can maybe sometimes we can assume the message is getting across it, sort of with the aggregate answer, when actually if you probe into the detail, you just go, oh right, okay, there's a bit more learning to be done here as well, just to pick up, not for everybody of course, but for some, you know, they think they're there when they're not, if you like, and actually just raising a visibility of that made a difference to understanding on the supply side as much as on the demand side. Okay. I think the other thing is certainly we've done research on licensing, whether systems which don't require a pre-licence inspection or registration without pre-licence inspection, in some places be sort of characterised almost as giving false assurance. You know, so the tenants are saying, oh, I'll look for a licensed landlord, registered landlord. Oh, here it is. But actually that didn't mean anything because they haven't had to go through any form of vetting in advance. Mm. So it's almost, giving tenants sort of false reassurance that everything's okay if the inspection comes later or only when a complaint, etc. So I think there is something there about, okay, about what it's telling, what signal it's sending to the rest of the market.
Okay, thanks. I'm going to bring in Pam Gosol with a question.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, Panu, and thank you for your opening statements. A common criticism of the emergency rent cap enacted in October 2022 was that it was not adequately consulted on and that it placed an undue burden on landlords. What lessons can be learned from this experiment, and how well do you think that the Housing Bill balances the rights of tenants with the rights of landlords? And could I start with Professor Ken, then maybe Professor Alex, and then Christian?
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, I think there is definitely a sense that in order to protect existing tenants, the design of the bill, the rent freeze and cap, didn't think through the consequences of it, in the sense that it created almost like a mandate for landlords when they had a new tenancy to let to raise rents, and so the affordability consequences of that were pretty severe, and the evidence in general, it seems to me, from adverts across the UK, was that for a period during the rent cap, our cities had the highest rent increases in the UK. And I'm not saying that was necessarily only caused by that, but it's clearly a factor in it. It also, I think, as is widely known from a qualitative sort of standpoint, led to the pausing and, in some cases, withdrawal of build-to-rent investment in Scotland, as well as a kind of political risks and uncertainties of that emerged. So it definitely had some of the consequences that more that some of the evidence says that more hard rent controls can have in terms of not being necessarily thought through about those consequences, or essentially saying that the needs of existing tenants facing the cost of living crisis is what's important, and not, in a sense, other tenants, other potential tenants, things about the mobility of the housing system and things, all of those things which were affected. Now, that may be, as a trade-off, something that in the short term may felt was acceptable because of the cost of living crisis, but it definitely appears to have had those wider effects as well.
Thank you. Before you come in, just we're quite keen to get the sense of the bill and whether it has the, you know, the right balance between the rights of tenants and the rights of landlords. That's a key point we want to get clear on.
In relation to the rent control provisions specifically, I think part of the answer to that depends on detail to be yet to be filled in. I mean, in terms of things like how the system's calibrated, in terms of and detailed design questions about, you know, exceptions or cost pass-throughs, all sorts of things that you can put into a rent control system in terms of what the rights of landlords look like, sort of like where the balance is being struck. So a rent control system in and of itself, you know, covers a multitude of possibilities in terms of where that balance sits in terms of the landlord's right to a return from their asset, for example, you know, so what that looks like. So it's a bit hard to answer that in relation to rent control particularly. I think some of the other provisions about things like personalisation seems to me to be an interesting recognition of some of the issues that tenants have been raising and representations they've been making about what makes a home and what sort of quiet enjoyment of a home means and things that will make them feel more settled in place. So I think there are elements of the bill that certainly are addressing long-standing concerns or issues that tenants have felt about that sense of precarity and how I can feel settled in a particular location. So I think there are certainly components of the bill which are moving the balance, but I think maybe moving a balance in a way that is positive for a sense of well-being for residents. Whether it infringes, again, too much on the rights of landlords is sort of, again, some of those detailed questions about who carries the risks around some of those, for example, around personalisation and what does it imply for deposits or what sorts of behaviours it will encourage to follow from that.
But there are measures in the bill, sure, that kind of meet that,
yes,
right? Around,
yes,
risk and around the tenant having to ask if they can do it, and, yes, then And the right to refuse it.
Yes. Oh, absolutely. So, but again, going back to this thing about, well, what as a tenant, how do I anticipate the landlord reacting to that, and will they? So there's a sort of background set of presumptions about rights and what's appropriate, and will this, it will shift the law, but will it shift some of those understandings about this is now the tenant's right? And if it doesn't, then in reality, it's not going to change the experience on the ground as far as we might like it to. So I think there's some of those sorts of issues in play as well, but it's moving in the right direction for, I think, allowing people to feel more settled in the private rent sector, which is important given they're often spending more time there as well.
Okay, thanks. Deborah.
I think from JRF's point of view, the bill's intention is very welcome. I think it does point to a bit of a culture shift. I think there's something quite specific about a home as an asset, which means that it needs to be treated differently to other things. And I haven't seen any pushback, really, from landlords in any of the submissions that have been put in writing. There's an acceptance, I think, now that if you make that property available for rent, you should be able to live in it, not just exist in it like some kind of long-term Airbnb where you're not allowed to touch anything, you don't cook anything. We want people to feel settled. And, you know, in the middle of a cost of living crisis, it might seem less important to talk about decorations or pets, but tenants tell us how very much important it is to them to make them feel at home and to help them live a normal and dignified life. We all need a warm, safe, secure accommodation that feels like ours, and that is part of how we'll achieve that. So to the extent that the bill starts putting some of those things much more explicitly on the books, I think it's great. In terms of the sort of balance between tenants and landlords, I think some of the grounds for eviction might need another look at. So, and again, it's quite difficult to disaggregate one of these elements from another. But I think one of the reasons that tenants are so keen on rent controls is because they need predictability and they need certainty. And they also need to know that landlords can't use unaffordable rent rises to evict them, kind of by default, if they raise concerns about repairs or they are unhappy about how quickly landlords get back to them or whatever. And so finding that balance in real life is going to be tricky. I won't go on.
Anybody else want to come in on this? Anna?
Yes, just to go back to Pam's original question around the rent control brought in through the cost of living, and thinking of that in relation to the rights of tenants and landlords, I think it's important to state that we knew in 2020 that most rent increases are at change of tenancy, and obviously this legislation in the cost of living legislation only affected in tenancy rent increases, and we know that the impact from our work, we know the impact of that has been that landlords, as a result of that, have hiked up rents at change of tenancy, and also that we've had seen an increase in the frequency of rent increases in tenancy. So I think it's created even further imbalance for tenants, actually, because of the probable unintended consequences for rent increases and more frequent rent increases.
Okay. And in terms of the bill that we're looking at right now, what do you have in terms of a sense of the balance between the rights of tenants?
I just think in terms of rent control and ensuring that the rights of tenants and lords are balanced, I think for tenants, it must be very carefully designed, because based on the evidence of what we know, how rents are increased and actually what was implemented, I'm not sure it was designed in the best way. So okay. Whatever is designed in future must be very careful.
Okay, thanks. Anybody else? Joshua?
Yeah, thank you.
Particularly on the balance between the rights of the tenants and landlords.
Yeah, in terms of rent control specifically or the whole?
It's the overall.
Yeah. Well, I mean, as I've mentioned, our sort of primary focus is on those renters who are vulnerable and at the bottom end of the system. And I think we know at the moment that the system isn't working for those people, so that the balance isn't right. And to just sort of give one example of a renter called Tony, who's engaged with the Rent Better research since 2021. He's at the time he first engaged, he was unemployed and his partner was in part-time work, meaning they struggled to afford their rent and got into debt. And their home was also in a bad state of repair with a broken boiler and damp. And Tony also had mental health problems, which meant he struggled to deal with that. And when he first spoke to the researchers, he'd just been served a notice to quit as his landlord was selling the property. And 2 years later, when he spoke to the researchers again, he told them of the immense stress in finding another place. He almost became homeless, only managing to find a place at the final hour. And he described the stress as like a bucket of cold water and how he was just frozen in shock. And now, although Tony and his partner are in full-time employment, they're still living with this repair that they can't get addressed, including mould and damp. And he wants to buy his own place, but is finding getting out of debt impossible. I think Tony's story gives us insight that the balance isn't there yet for people in that situation. Notwithstanding, as I have said, that obviously many landlords are doing a good job and providing a good home, but for too many renters, the balance isn't right.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey on the theme of rent.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, everybody. Just, I wonder if I could invite you to say just a few words about rent levels in the private rented sector. Traditionally, they're higher, perhaps much higher. And I'll turn to Deborah, because you made a few comments that I think are important, Deborah, in telling us that a third of renters, according to your research, are living in poverty, and they're folk that are at the sharpest end of the cost of living crisis. So just maybe a word or two about rent levels, which presumably is a precursor behind and driving the government towards this legislation.
Yes, thank you. So, yes, one in three renters in the private rented sector are living in poverty, and I think I also said there's a good chunk of people who are just above the poverty line as well. And for them, long-term and expensive and unpredictable private rented sector is probably not the right place for them. Average rents in Scotland have gone up to, I think, £925 a month for a two-bedroom. I might have to correct that on the record, but it's something in that ballpark. And they have gone up, as Ken said, quite significantly. It was 730 back in 2019. So that gives you some idea of the sort of ramping up that we've seen. But it would be remiss of me not to mention that what's happening in the rest of the UK is pretty horrifying as well, where there are no rent controls, where the private sector has been allowed to continue untrammelled by any of the regulation that is in place now, or indeed is being discussed as a result of this bill. And they are seeing rising homelessness, temporary accommodation figures, just shockingly high. All the things that we are wrestling with, they are wrestling with, for slightly different reasons. But the structural drivers underpinning the housing system are the same. And so whether our rent increases are a bit ahead of England, but not quite as far ahead as London, is kind of neither here nor there, because the gaps facing individual households are significant. Ken mentioned local housing allowance, obviously set by the UK government. It's just been reset, which is very welcome, but it is the bottom 30% of rents, and it is out of date as soon as it is published, so we must get that right. But the Scottish Government also has levers at its disposal, which is about topping LHA up, and it has put some welcome additional monies into discretionary housing payments. But there are people, including renters in the PRS, who are not eligible for those kinds of payments. And so we do have to think about who is most affected by those gaps, and what support can we put in place them, because we can't let them be fully exposed to the kind of increases that we're talking about.
Any other message for Anna?
Yes, just to endorse that data, advertised rents are now an average of about 1,000. Obviously, some areas are more expensive, like Edinburgh, and some markets are relatively affordable. So in the Ayrshires, for example, there are rents that are similar to social rents. So we can't, you know, average rents have to be, you know, taken with a bit of caution, but on average, 1,000. And that has risen from about 750 since 2017. So, you know, one of the intentions of the private residential tenancy was to manage excessive rent increases, and we've concluded that that hasn't been achieved. We've also found that many tenants say that they're paying over a third of their income on housing costs, and over a quarter are paying more than 40% of their income on housing costs. And there does seem to be a bit of disconnect between the amount that tenants are paying on rents and what they believe is affordable. And it seems that because these high rents are now the norm, that has been normalised and people just believe that we have to pay a lot of our income on rent. So I think that's an important point.
OK. Thanks very much for that. Probably a couple of questions directed more towards Ken and Alec, if I may. Your research urges some caution about making international comparisons about rent controls and so on. So could you tell us a wee bit more about that, please? And the evidence that you suggest is we need to challenge and interpret the evidence that's coming forward in rent control a bit more thoroughly, I think, Ken, you mentioned. So could you maybe tell us a little bit about both of those two issues, please?
Sure. I'll just start by saying that one of the things we make the point, you know, that with the exception of rent pressure zones, which of course never introduced, we've been in a kind of non-rent control world since the late 1980s in the UK. So we don't have direct evidence from the UK, so we are drawn to other places. But our point is that, I think amongst other things, is that local markets and their context are really important to trying to work out what the effects of rent control are, as are the institutional processes around how the housing system works in those places. So seeing a specific policy design of a certain kind and simply translating it and expecting the same effects is really needs to be filtered through those kinds of issues. And that's not easy. And it just should make us a bit cautious. So we've seen in the grey literature in particular a number of evidence reviews which really just don't ignore all, they just ignore all of that and just assume that what happens in Washington State or in Northern California can just be directly attributed, applied to the whole of the UK. And so we're understandably very cautious about that. But I think it also means the corollary of that is that in thinking about interventions into markets in the UK and in Scotland, we need to take proper account of how the local market works, how it interacts with social housing and the owner-occupied sector, and also the ways in which our institutions, like the social security system, have an effect, which you wouldn't see because it's not the same system in Sweden or the Netherlands or wherever you're looking at. Is that reasonable?
Absolutely, yes. Yeah, no, that's absolutely the point. And I think the role of another component of that is sort of the role the private rented sector plays in the overall housing system. So obviously one of the recent episodes of rent control internationally that's attracted a lot of attention is what's happened in Berlin, as one of the places that's experimented, including other places like sort of Catalonia. But in Berlin, you know, 83% of people live in private rented sector. So in that sense, you know, a rent freeze, which is what they introduced after the rent break, you know, has a huge impact on the whole system, and it had the sort of predictable impacts of a rent freeze. But equally, in terms of your point about how we should be challenged the evidence or interpret the data, certainly both Berlin and Catalonia as recent examples. In Catalonia, there's a bit of evidence that suggests that they had rent control and it didn't have significant negative effects on housing supply. But one of the interesting things about both those international examples, before we sort of embrace them with enthusiasm, is that in both cases, I think from the start, there was a sort of constitutional question over whether the laws were going to stand, whether these were lawful interventions. And both in Berlin and in Catalonia, the Constitutional Court concluded that it wasn't. So what effect that the evidence is sort of trying to get at or trying to explore now is to what extent were landlords sort of holding off and waiting for the judgment? So they say, well, OK, so there's rent control has come in. We're going to live with it for a little bit and see what the Constitutional Court decides. And then if it decides it's unconstitutional, we're fine. We carry on as we were. On the other hand, if the Constitutional Court says this law stands, then we'll see the behavioural response by landlords, because okay, right, now we're not so when we're getting studies of the short-term effects of some of these international interventions, but how we read what they're saying, you know, we need to just be a little bit cautious about it. So that's I think what we mean by sort of being willing to challenge some of the evidence. Mm-hmm. I mean, the one thing we can say I think is it just in terms of accumulation is almost everywhere there's been a rent freeze and whatever system, whatever institutional context, that the best you can say is it doesn't have a strongly negative effect. Yeah, that's the best you can say. But typically what you say is if it sticks, it will have a negative effect.
Yeah. How do we avoid grafting on to the Scottish legislation, say the downtown Washington legislation, and avoid those situations that you described earlier, Ken? What's the safety mechanism and the flexibilities that we need to push into the system to make sure we don't do that?
Well, I mean, two levels, I think. A lot of due diligence in thinking about the design and locating it in real markets. And secondly, alongside that, I think is and this kind of is something I'm sure we'll come back to when we talk about data, is also that we simply need a consistent level of rigorous market analysis that feeds into these things. And that's a really big ask, but actually, I've always felt that's a really important, necessary condition of having any hope of working with the grain of markets and trying to understand what's happening and trying to understand what the consequences of controls might be.
Yeah. Alex? If I may, just to follow up on that point, just to follow that up, which is one of the useful things I think that has come out of the Californian literature, not so much the finding, the broad finding, which is the profile of the supply side makes a difference. So what types of landlords are operating in your local market makes a difference to how it will respond to a particular rent control regime. So what sort of corporate landlords or sort of small-scale individual, the actual characteristics, their business models, what they're looking for in their from their business, is it long-term return, is it short-term income maximisation? Some of those things will affect the way in which the intervention plays out in terms of people exiting the market or not. So the headline message: understand the market and its sort of the motivation of the actors, and then think about okay, what sorts of designs would work, ignoring what they found in relation to the substance of what happened in San Francisco.
And presumably local flexibility for the councils to adapt the policy to local needs if they have the data that enables them to come to those decisions, I presume. Yeah. Okay. We talked about unintended consequences earlier. I think, Anna, you specifically mentioned some possible effects of rent controls. Could you maybe just flesh out a little bit more of what you mean, what we could face in terms of unintended consequences if we introduce the rent controls as proposed in the bill?
Well, I think what the literature says repeatedly is there are things that we could look out for and try to design taking account of it, and that's that notion of insiders and outsiders, that the people who are already in the system who benefit from rent control, depending on the design, may get advantages that future tenants might not get because there'll be a shortage of property. If that's the case, that's an empirical question, but if that's the case, then the insiders benefit relative to the outsiders. It may also restrict and reduce the mobility of the insiders. They'll have less of incentive to leave. I was talking to a colleague just a few weeks ago who was telling a story about living in an HMO in Glasgow and having no intention to move because they were, and this was before the rent cap ended, but because that protected them, even if they weren't particularly happy with all the aspects of the tenancy, it was a trade-off between those two things. So the design was having a direct impact on their decisions that they collectively were making, and that's a concern. And clearly the big question that is the one that people argue about the most is the supply-side response to that, which I think we would certainly say is not straightforward, and it's not a binary, this will definitely happen or that will definitely happen. But, wanting to think really hard before the introduction of the policy to think about those consequences and think how they match up with the kind of vision or the strategic purpose that the rental market has within the kind of broader housing strategy. That's there.
Thanks again. Anna, since you mentioned specifically unintended consequences.
Yeah, I'm not sure we can isolate out specifically the impacts of the rent control through the cost of living and potentially this bill, what this bill is proposing, but I think it's rather a cumulative effect of the scale and pace of regulation that has happened in Scotland in the PRS, combined with the constrained market and the significant changes in terms of a volatile financial market for landlords and for tenants. We have seen a reduction, a relatively recent reduction in the amount of stock in the private rented sector. We have seen a reduction in the number of lets, and we have seen that many landlords have made significant rent increases at change of tenancy to reflect those increased risks. We also know, as I've said previously, that others have increased rents more frequently, and that long-term renters have experienced rent increases that they haven't before. As I said, you know, the norm is to increase rents at change of tenancy, but some long-term renters are seeing rent increases more frequently. And we also know that letting agents are most definitely more inclined to increase rents more regularly and at a steeper rate that some landlords would, individual landlords would do. And so I think taking all of those things in around, but and lack of movement, as Ken has spoken about, that if you know that it's much more expensive elsewhere in the market, you're just going to sit tight. That's a problem. That lack of movement is a problem. And in the whole housing system, you do need movement to meet needs and demands. So I think taken in the round, I don't think you can isolate out. You have to look at it as the whole system and all the different impacts. I think there have been some negative impacts.
Okay, thanks very much. Joshua?
Thank you. Yeah, if I just add a couple of extra points on Tana's excellent summary there. I think one additional thing to note is obviously we know that sort of what a lot of landlords are saying at the moment and a lot of landlord representative groups is that that they plan to exit the market if some of these regulations come into place. But I think one interesting point to note is that in 2019, at the start of our research, we asked landlords about their future plans to leave following the introduction of the PRT. And since then, of course, landlords have seen far greater challenges than they would have anticipated in 2019 with the mortgage rates issues and the pandemic. But the evidence does strongly suggest that nevertheless, they've not left the market in anything like the amounts that they said they were going to. So there is basically a history of landlords overestimating their likelihood to leave the sector following the introduction of legislation. And if I can just make sort of one broader point about the rent control measures, I think, as I've already sort of intimated, that the key point in this is that we can't see rent control in isolation. We need to take a holistic approach to the whole housing sector and look at why the demand is so high within the sector and therefore why that's in balance with supply. And that means expanding other avenues for renters, particularly renters who are most vulnerable, to find a home. So expanding the social rented sector and other options for genuinely affordable housing.
Okay, thanks very much. Lastly, from your bit of capacity, somebody said it's one thing having legislation, but it's another thing to have the capacity to put it into force and so on. It might have been you again, Deborah. Forgive me if it wasn't, but could you just tell us a little bit more? What do we mean by that? I mean, I know East Ayrshire, for example, has got private sector liaison officers that do quite a lot of work exchanging with the private rented sector. So is this a duty, an additional duty that would fall on them? Or do we need to have other resource to deliver this, do you think?
I'm not sure what the bill drafters have in mind about how that might be done. I'm just reflecting conversations I've had with colleagues in local authorities and in the wider housing sector who tell me that local authority departments are under incredible pressure, partly related to the housing emergency and homelessness statistics, and that therefore simply adding one more duty to their long list of things to do won't make it happen. So I do think we need to have a proper look at the data that we need, not just for the purposes of this, but more broadly in the housing sector.
Thanks, Deborah. Anna, on capacity, then she'll have capacity.
I think we also need to remember independent information and advice providers, for example, Citizens Advice Bureau is typically what tenants will first mention if they think that they need some advice. And like many third sector organisations, their funding is under pressure as well. So it's capacity in the broader sense, not just local authority PRS advisors. It's that independent sector, which I think tenants are more inclined to go to.
Good. Thanks very much for that. No other comments on capacity? I'm happy to pass back to the convener.
Thanks, Gordon. You indicated you wanted a brief supplementary.
Additional question. Alec, you spoke about international comparisons. I noticed in your written evidence that you highlighted that in Germany, landlords have to advertise their proposed rent offer, but also the ceiling for that area in the rent control areas. I was just wondering if you could see if that had any impact on the market.
So those types of mechanisms. So in some of these systems where there was a constitutional question, they were almost advertising two rents at the same time. They were sort of saying, well, this is the rent if rent regulation sticks, and this will be the rent if the Constitutional Court declares it to be unconstitutional. So in some cases, a significant gap between the two. I mean, I think that, and Catalonia, they also obliged the rents to be visible on sort of advert to try to... I mean, I think that's to overcome the sort of information asymmetry, because in other... In other systems where it's sort of there's a register somewhere of what the regulated rent is and the tenant's got to go and find it sort of thing, those sorts of systems tend to get swamped by I need somewhere to live, and if this is what the rent is, I'm going to pay it, and it might well not be the regulated rent, but you know, we'll have to overlook that because I need somewhere to live. Yeah. So it's an attempt to sort of dissuade, I guess, to I think that the evidence as far as we can tell is that the impact, the downward pressure on rents is greater when it is visible at that stage. Mm-hmm. At the stage, you know, the landlords have to make it visible up front because the tenants are aware of it. And landlords, I guess, have got a stronger disincentive to push the rent above that or argue against it. I mean, that's the formal rent. I don't think we've got much research on things like side payments and key money, what else might be going on around it, yeah. But sort of posted rents and rents being paid. Compliance with a regime is greater where it's more visible, more like that.
Thanks very much.
Indicated. You want to come
in? Just want to make two quick points, really following on from Willie's questions. Like, one is about capacity and enforcement, and in a sense there's a case for pushing some of this back to the Scottish Government, I think, in the sense that a very good example of effective learning of doing market analysis flowed from the local housing systems analysis work, which was the evidence base for strategies before housing needs and demand assessment. And what was key there was that the Scottish Government provided a lot of data. They also monitored the quality of market analysis being done by each local authority partnership. It's actually a very good incentive compatible way of doing these things. And I kind of feel that we're going to need something like that if we're going to have confidence in a baseline consistency in the level of market analysis that will be required to assess what rental data means in local places. So some of that work can be done at the centre of the Scottish Government, the housing market analysis team and various other people. The other thing I was going to say was, while agreeing with all that was said about the likelihood of supply decline, a factor that we've not discussed is a kind of demographic one as well, that Alex and I have talked before about the sense that there's probably a cohort of buy-to-let landlords who are simply reaching retirement age and are considering getting rid of their assets, liquidating them. And to that extent, you know, there's a force that goes beyond the strong incentives, but will be magnified by it in a sense. I think it's worth being that we don't really know what the actual magnitudes of those things are, but the fact is a lot of people became buy-to-let landlords about 15, 20 years ago, and they probably may well feel they're coming to the end of their term. Mm.
Okay, just before I bring Anna in, I just wanted to... Ken, you talked about pushing things back to the Scottish Government in terms of that market analysis. I would also like to ask you if you think that putting the duty on ministers to decide whether or not to propose to designate a rent control area informed by the local authorities will actually protect those local authorities from the pressure and indeed legal risk, because that's the difference, isn't it, with the control area over the pressure zones?
Yeah, I mean, I think it all goes back to the quality of decisions and the evidence that those decisions are based on and having confidence on, and they have to be consistent. They have to be consistent across the whole of the nation. Otherwise, it's not really a national policy. You know, that there are issues there. And there's always going to be a concern that you'll get, for different capacity reasons, etc., you'll have different ability to do the kind of job. And equally, the centre of the government has to have a really consistent view to take. Obviously, we still don't know what the kinds of caps are going to apply are, and even things like that, that needs to be carefully worked out. But I think if the Scottish Government went some of the way in providing the data and the kind of framework in which people did that analysis, that would be a considerable help. And there would be opportunities for people to get a kind of consistent training in how to undertake that, because that just doesn't exist anymore on a consistent basis.
Okay, thanks. Anna, you indicated you want to come in, and I have a sense that Deborah, you want to come in as well. So Anna and then Deborah.
It was just to confirm Ken's point about the tenure of landlords. We know from the quantitative surveys that we've done with the five-year difference between 2019 and 2024 that there is an increase in longevity of landlords and a decreasing proportion of younger landlords that have had stock for less. So that profile is increasing towards the longer landlords and probably the older landlords. We didn't ask them their age, but and the impact of that will be age and stage of landlords.
In your research, do you have a sense of where the younger landlords are going with their... Are they just selling their property?
No, they're just not coming in.
They're just not coming in. Okay. Yeah. Okay, Deborah.
Yeah, I suppose two very brief points. One is back to the kind of private rented sector that you might want and the kind of landlords that you might want. JRF is quite clear that we do want to see a smaller, more professionally managed private rented sector that meets the needs of tenants and landlords, and that probably means moving the people who are in the most vulnerable circumstances out of that as a long-term option, not necessarily as a short-term option. And even in Ken's own research, the build-to-rent sector, if I remember correctly, weren't opposed to rent controls of some sort as long as it was a stable environment and it was something which they could make a return. So I do think one thing... I understand why the government undertook the rent controls in the manner in which they did. It was an emergency. They didn't want to scare the market. They made some deliberate design decisions about trying to allow landlords to reset rents between tenancies. They did that deliberately to try and give landlords a bit of leeway. And you have heard from the panel about the impact that that has had. It's great for existing tenants. It's caused an acceleration elsewhere. But actually, you could design a process that has a sort of long-term drumbeat of rent control that provides certainty for tenants, which is what tenants tell us they want. They want a predictable sense of how much their rent is going to be when they stay in their property, and provides a certain amount of predictability and certainty for build to rent. But the thing that was missing, because it was an emergency situation, is that idea about taking landlords along with us. So as part of the design, the need to really think through the design, we need to take people with us, and it would be good to do that in an open and transparent and quite open-minded way, because I think there are some win-wins. There are some landlords that will want to exit. There are some landlords that will want to purchase and socialise private rented properties, but we're not bringing people along with us. So that would be my very general point.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm going to just check, Pam, if you wanted to come back in.
I do, yeah. Thank you, convener. Analysis of figures by the ONS has shown that the average rents in Scotland have increased by 16.5% since the introduction of rent cap in October 2022, faster than elsewhere in the United Kingdom. Do you have any evidence on how this cap impacted the experience of tenants and landlords, as well as the supply of privately rented accommodation?
Who wants to pick that up?
Go. I mean, I think we've said some of the examples of where these effects seem to have occurred. And I would really just re-emphasise what Deborah's just said. We spoke to a Swedish investor who invested across Europe within rent control systems and free market systems. And their point was, if there's political predictability, if the political risk and uncertainty is low, and stable, then it's perfectly possible to make rent control rents work in a diversified portfolio. I think the sense that one gets from investors potentially investing and starting to invest in build-to-rent, particularly in Glasgow and Edinburgh, was that this wasn't a predictable environment and that they were unsure what was going to happen going forward. And they will need to be reassured in some way if people view that's a significant and important thing that Build to Rent continues. The consultation before the bill explicitly said there could be some exemptions from the rent control, and actually in brackets said Build to Rent ? That's still there in the bill as a possibility. So that's maybe one of the bits of thinking that's going on behind the state of the bill as it currently is. So that may be one of the lessons learned, in a sense, from what happened in the last 2 years. Again, from what Deborah's just said, it'd be really interesting to know what the Build to Rent investors make of that and whether they feel that's sufficient to create an environment that they would invest in.
I think, sorry, Professor Kent, you're absolutely right. I mean, we've heard the evidence. It's all about certainty, what the market brings. And obviously, supply is a big issue because that's what we need, supply more to make sure. And I think you mentioned earlier on that the fact that more people are leaving because of the age of the people that are renting. So we need to make sure that supply is carrying on. But I think Deborah wants to come in here.
Just a slightly fearful point in case the academics shoot me down, but my understanding of the ONS figures is that Scotland's isn't directly comparable to the rest of the UK. There is a note in the technical blurble which basically says that the bank of rents on which we judge that rapid increase that you've identified is largely asking rents within Scotland, and it's a better mix in the other countries. So I don't doubt for a moment that we have had those rapid increases, but I just want to urge a little bit of caution about having too much certainty, I guess, in those figures just at the moment.
Thanks, Ken. And then Joshua, and then we'll move on.
I was just going to say that I think Deb is absolutely right that it's only recently that the ONS data is not described as experimental anymore. It does have a weighting in it for existing rents, but the underlying quality of the data just isn't as good in Scotland as it is elsewhere. So broad rental market area data, for instance, is much, much better in somewhere like Wales than it is in Scotland, for instance. But we do very heavily rely on advertised rents and also the data that's used for the broad rental market areas, which are also heavily weighted towards new lights as well. But as someone said to me recently, advertised rents aren't particularly representative of the market as a whole, but they're also the rents that disadvantaged low-income people face when they try to get a new tenancy, and that's obviously true as well.
Thank you. I think it's just worth one point to be really clear that of the positives for renters of the recent in-tenancy rent cap period, during the rent cap period, of course, rent rises didn't go above 3%, but our research shows that before that, where tenants did see rent increases during their tenancies, they're often, more often than not, above 3%, and sometimes as high as 10% or 20% or more. Although advertised rents have, of course, risen dramatically, as my colleagues have said, that's because there hasn't been anything done to limit those rises in between tenancies. But within tenancies, it was a really impactful thing for tenants, giving them certainty, giving them restrictions on their rents, which made things more affordable for them. So if we are going to take action on rents, something has to be done to address that gap in the rise in advertised rents.
I'm going to move on just because of time and unleash the questions on data that I think everybody's been keen to get a bit more detail on by bringing in Mark Griffin with some questions.
Yeah, thanks, Cumira. Good morning. Yep, I have a couple of questions about data. And first of all, you've talked about the ONS data, but just to ask members of the panel if they have any comments on the availability of data beyond that, which would inform the policy decisions that we have. Is there sufficient data out there to inform the decisions that we are in the process of making?
Okay, so in principle there is that data, in principle that data can be collected, and a central part of what the bill is trying to do, I think, is to find a mechanism by which all rental data gets collected and systematically. If you go back to the 2021-22 consultation, there was a kind of hope running through the data section that the landlord registration process would provide that by simply adding property characteristics and rents such like to that. And we kind of moved away from that, but the bill seems to have come back to that, but doing it in a specific way, the notion of local authorities asking for that data, fines for non-compliance, etc. And over a period of time, that will hopefully generate a much more balanced kind of set of data, which gets rid of that problem about the advertised rents problem or bias. But it will take time. It's absolutely not clear how well such a model will actually work in practice. It seems to me that trying to use some of the things we talked about earlier on about the safe, secure nature of the property, that there are data issues that landlord registration could also work with that. So it's a for a long time, I think people have thought it was the natural way to collect such data. I don't really see any other obvious way of collecting the volumes of data that are required, particularly for existing tenancies, without using that mechanism, which is there. It's there to be applied, but we're a long way before getting to that, actually being able to work and build. And it will take time. It will take time for that. There's enough data to use. It begs questions about the three-year lag in landlord registration data. We really need annual data at the least, you know. So.
Yeah, I don't have anything to add to that.
So could we change that lag in this bill, that three-year lag?
I think it would need a change to the regulations, the landlord registration regulations. Presumably that could be done. But yes, at the moment, landlords only have to re-register every 3 years. So there is an inbuilt lag of 3 years in the register.
Okay, thanks. Mark, you've got another question now.
Yeah, but it's just on specifically on that proposal to give local authorities the power to request information on rent, and just ask what extent that information will be necessary to then make decisions on implementing a rent control area or not, and you know how long it's going to take from the point of having the power to collect that data to then be able to be in a position to make a decision on implementing or not a rent control area. Deborah?
I think that is the inherent problem, and it's certainly part of JRF's concern that if we've got a mechanism that we want to use and a crisis that we want to use it against, it will take 3 or 4 years before we're at the point where we could design something. And I think there's a sort of first order question to answer first as part of the design process between now and then, which is whether a local system or a national system is a better approach. So we talked earlier on in the evidence about the whether unintended or otherwise, part of the design of the current rent controls has supported existing tenants and created behavioural responses elsewhere. Scotland's quite a small place. You could see that you could have areas that are within rent control areas and see quite sharp rises for areas that are out with that control. We have to decide whether that's the way in which we want to do it. And part of that is about whether we want rent controls to be a permanent part of the landscape or whether we want it to sort very specific issues. But I think your concerns about the timescale are right. I mean, back in 2019 when there was the Fair Rents Bill that also came before the Parliament, we did ask then that we needed to collect the data first in order to inform the design of rent controls. In some ways, we've gone the other way, which is we've done an experiment. Now we need to learn the lessons from that and use that in the design process for anything that we want to take forward therein.
Anna?
Yes, I would agree with both Ken and Deborah, and I think the key issue is the quality assurance around the data, and I do tend to conclude that it might be better to have a centralised approach because, as many of us will know, that there's variability of capacity, skills and resources in local government, and you will get very different responses in the ability to collect and for that data to be robust at the local level. So my inclination would be that, for example, Centre for Housing Market analysis might be a good conduit for that collection, the quality assurance around it, and then for local authorities to be given that data and decide what to do with it in terms of a potential rent control area.
Okay, just one final question, just on publication of that data. You know, any tenant or any prospective tenant can go to the national website, put in the address and check landlord registration. Do you think the data collected on rent should be published in the same way?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thanks. I just want to explore a little bit on the data collection piece around. So at the moment, landlords have to, we kind of touched on a little bit when we were talking about the landlord register earlier, but just want a little bit more on that. So landlords have to meet basic safety and environmental standards with a gas safety check and the electoral certificate and the EPC certification. And I'd be interested to understand if any of you have a sense of what the advantages of that would be and the feasibility of requiring landlords to provide that, but also that they provide it proactively rather than local authorities having to request it. Yeah, anybody got any thoughts on that? Could that be a useful way of... So last week we talked with the bill team about the purpose of the bill, about that being related to the experience of somebody renting accommodation. Any thoughts? Deborah and then Alex.
I think it's important that all properties that are being rented out are rented out to a very high standard, and that anybody moving into those properties can have some assurance that those checks and balances have been done. I guess it depends whether you think that that is best mediated through information given between landlord and tenant, or whether you think that that's something between landlords and local authorities as part of that sort of quality assurance process. Certainly from the work that we have done with tenants, they can be a bit overwhelmed at the point of tenancy with huge amounts of information. And actually what we want is for them to be assured that their property is of a high standard. So I think there's probably a simpler way to do that, which is about landlords making that information available and keeping that up to date as part of a beefed up process of landlord registration, which you're describing.
Okay, thanks. That's very helpful. Now going to move on to questions from Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks very much, convener. I'm going to ask about rent adjudication and what your views are and how we can improve it. But Deborah, I wanted to ask you a quick follow-up. When you sell a property, you have to produce a home report. Should there be something similar for landlords when they're putting a property on the market for rent?
I do think there's value in that, and I think it was an idea that came out of the project that Alex and some of his colleagues did with us. That's what tenants wanted. They wanted a summary. They wanted a home report, which provided the assurance that we've just been talking about, rather than a 40-page inventory with lots of photos on about, you know, what the state of the windowsill looks like. So they want to know that the boiler is working, that it's high quality, that there's windows and so on. So, yes, I think there would be value in that. You'd have to balance that with the cost of producing it. So in a sale, obviously, some of those costs can be defrayed in terms of, you know, any profit that you might make. So there are some questions about who pays for that and how detailed and so on. But, again, as per my answer with the last question, I think there's a relatively straightforward technological answer to some of that, about how you might do it, so which could potentially keep the costs down for landlords.
Okay, thanks very much. So we've talked an awful lot this morning about the importance of this tenant-landlord relationship, and you know that may have an impact on the low number of people that have rent adjudication. We've also got vulnerable tenants who might not know have the knowledge of how they appeal. Somebody, I think it was maybe yourself, Anna, that said, if there's no alternative home, you're not going to complain. So how do we improve, what needs to be done to improve the take-up of rent adjudication, given that minefield? Who wants to come in first? Yeah, Anna?
I think at the basic level, it goes back to my previous points about information and advice. I don't think it's just vulnerable tenants. I think the majority of tenants don't have that knowledge. and know what the process is. I mean, we know from the rent officer data that we've been provided through Scottish Government is that there's only 227 cases have been raised since 2017, and we've estimated that at under 1% of all PRTs. I mean, we know from a few interviews with, but there weren't, because it's so low, we've only got one interview, longitudinal interview with a tenant that have experienced adjudication. And his general description of it was that it was difficult, it was bureaucratic, there was lots of paperwork, there was lots of legal jargon, he didn't understand the process that was going on. And he also appealed and went to tribunal as well. So he was obviously quite motivated and exercised about the whole thing. But even with that, it was a difficult process. So I think there needs to be more information, advice, and that the whole process needs to be simplified for tenants to encourage, you know, them to take that up.
Okay. Anybody else want to come in? Deborah?
I'm sorry to keep using the D word, but there's a data problem here as well, because the bank of rents against which a rent officer would have to understand whether that rent is reasonable or not is also not very good. So we sort of keep going back to the beginning. Longer term, you could have something that was a little bit more straightforward. The current one is, there's a really great calculator on the Scottish Government's website. That's very helpful. The actual calculation is a little bit complicated, but that has been made very, very simple, which shows that, you know, it can be done. But if you had a straightforward system where rents were assumed to rise only in line with inflation or with earnings growth, for example, once we're at steady state, that would be a much easier process to manage. At the moment, we're trying to compare sort of apples and asparagus and hope that tenants will take that all the way through so that we've got some sense of it. But it's a very clunky mechanism against a data bank that isn't terribly reliable. So just one final anecdote. Tenants aren't able to ascertain whether their rent rises are reasonable or unreasonable because they don't have access to the data. So a friend of mine has been given a rent increase, said, "What is this?" I had to go and look on the published data set myself. And actually, depending on how wide I drew the local area in which he lived, I got a wildly different response. And I had to say to him, "Don't bother," because actually the rent increase it looks bad, but actually it's defensible. And that, you know, that's part of the challenge.
Some of the evidence we've heard was around the fact that Rent Service Scotland had the ability to increase rents more than was being asked for. And that's proposed to be removed in this bill. What impact do you think that'll have? Will it increase the numbers, do you think? Or is it getting back to this long-term tenant landlord relationship? Yeah.
Well, there's only been one case where the rent officer has increased the rent.
Right.
So, and I don't know to what extent there's knowledge of that. So I don't think it would necessarily encourage tenants to... What tenants need to know that they can go through this process. Maybe they should be told that the majority of rents that were considered by the rent officer reduced, which they did. It was about 63% of rents that were considered by the rent officer have reduced. So maybe they should know that. But the increase is the increase prospect, that's only happened in one case since 2017.
Okay, Joshua.
I do think it's worth noting as well, however, having sort of advised renters in a previous job, that when you have to advise someone about going through that process and you have to tell them, you know, you have to forewarn them of the risk and say there is a risk your rent will go up, you know, that just dramatically decreases the likelihood that they're actually going to attempt that process, given how difficult it is anyway, and that then the rent could still even be higher than it is proposed.
Okay. And my last question is addressed to Joshua and Anna, and it's about the research you did. It states low-income tenants do not feel secure in their private rented homes and continue to fear eviction if they complain or challenge landlord activity. Can you say a wee bit more about that?
Yeah, it really comes back to the earlier point about the fact there's lack of choice.
Mm-hmm.
tenants feel secure, not because of their legal security, but because of affordability, their financial circumstances, and the relationship with the landlord. So if a dispute does emerge and they look at the alternatives, there are very few affordable alternatives. And so that creates a position of less power, less inclination to challenge because I won't be able to afford that alternative, or that alternative just isn't there.
And is there anything we can do to address that?
There needs to be more supply, affordable rented supply for people on low income and those vulnerable to harm for whom the private rented sector is not the best option.
I think just in terms of tenants' feeling of insecurity, there probably is one quite specific thing that could be done, and that's around the abuse of current no-fault eviction grounds. And the evidence that RentVet has produced shows that in 20% of cases where a landlord sought to evict a renter saying they were going to sell the property, in 20% of those cases, the property didn't actually get sold. So it shows that one in five of those cases, that the landlord is actually acting unlawfully. And tenants obviously are somewhat aware of that and know that that's a risk, that their landlord could abuse these grounds for eviction. And if I can just give sort of one example, one person we spoke to was Luke, a renter who lived in a property with rats and maggots falling through the kitchen ceiling. And the landlord refused to address those issues. So Luke eventually took his landlord to the Scottish Tribunal, who made the landlord do the repairs, which obviously sounds great. But then shortly afterwards, Luke was evicted using the sale ground. His landlord said he was going to sell the property. But then Luke later saw the property back on the market re-let. So that's just one example of the abuse of those grounds. And that obviously creates a real feeling of insecurity amongst renters, knowing that that could happen.
Is there anything that can be done to enforce a situation with landlords, or should there be a series of fines on landlords if they do not follow through on what they originally proposed?
So I think the first thing to do is to increase the evidential requirements on landlords to prove what they're doing, and then potentially introduce a sort of a point at which they have to return and prove that they've actually carried out that sale, or give evidence as to why the sale's fallen through or something like that. And the other thing that can be potentially done is prohibit landlords from re-letting the property for an extended period, and then obviously include fines or other sanctions if they do that.
Okay, thanks very much.
Okay, thanks, Gordon. Deborah, did you want to come in? Okay, I'm going to move on to our last area of questioning. I'm going to bring in Miles Briggs around implementation.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thanks for joining us today. I wanted to ask two questions around implementation, and specifically from the research which you've been doing, what lessons you think the Scottish Government could learn in terms of how any new legislative change will be implemented, and I'd look at some of the emergency legislation, for example, which Parliament's passed and then had to reconsider. So the social rented sector made some specific concerns around the rent freeze. They were taken out of the legislation by the government in the end. Mid-market rent still sits within that, and there's concerns over the impact that's having, especially here in my own area in Edinburgh, where that the building of these homes has just completely dried up. So just wondered, there are two lessons I've put forward, but if there's other things you would like to tell us about today. I don't know who wants to start first on.
Anybody want to pick that up? Anna. Okay, Anna and then Deborah.
A short straw.
Yeah.
Yes, I agree. I think this all comes back to the design of any prospective, if there is to be rent control. I think mid-market rent is an important part of the system to supply for good quality, affordable rented housing. Obviously, it's more expensive than social rent, but it is still within a more regulated sector. Typically subsidiary of housing associations, so is by its nature more professional. And I think it does come back to the design question of getting the balance of not disincentivizing and making sure that supply does follow through. I don't think I've got anything more to add to that.
Deborah, anything to add?
Yeah, I was just going to say some of that and then repeat the point I made earlier about bringing stakeholders along with us in terms of the actual design process, not just unveiling it at the end. Their business models have to work, and I think you're right. I think there is a good case for MMR, which is already a submarket rent pegged to other incomes, and therefore it seems crazy to subject it to the same rent control as would apply to the private rent sector if open markets are being set.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the lessons that must arise from 2022 is the fact that if you don't like design the contract or the policy well in the first place, you're going to have to spend a lot of time enforcing it and revising it. So I'm sure Scottish Government civil servants spent a lot of time working with the social rented sector and the SFHA and others. That might have been avoided if it had been done prior, but of course the nature of the way that the bill came forward was that it all happened very quickly, and so, you know, there's a very obvious lesson in that, and that's important. I mean, we're stuck here in a kind of set of trade-offs, it seems to me. Doing the thing right is really important. Obviously, any intervention of this kind needs to be sustainable and resilient, but we need to learn how to do that, so things will take time. So we, in some of the early research we did, we talked to stakeholders about how they would like to see such legislation implemented before we knew what the legislation was. And some people talked about pilots and running pilots through and then drawing lessons from that, but that's just adding years onto the kind of exactly the things that Deborah was talking about. Doing it well means sometimes taking longer, and that may not be an acceptable trade-off to make.
Yeah. Sorry, Alex, did you want to come on that?
Just to reinforce that point, but looping back to the point about uncertainty and the predictability of the environment, as you know, so in terms of for business planning, for institutional investment, is, you know, getting it right first time, saying, well, actually, this is a regime that's going to be in place for an extended period rather than rushing it and then having to change it again in a couple of years' time, you've just continued to generate uncertainty as a consequence.
I'll maybe bring you in, Joshua, because I know Nationwide Foundation's submission states that a wider scheme of tenant support and enforcement is needed. So I just wondered if you could outline more of what that might look like, and if other panel members also have anything to add. The House report, which we've already heard some information, I think is an interesting concept, but again, kind of what that looks like, and to go back to your point, Alex, for the sector to have certainty over what's then needed, who's going to do that work as well, both in local government and the housing sector as well. So maybe bring you in, as I specifically was looking at your submission.
Yeah, thank you. I think obviously it returns to some of the points we've already made around the need for a variety of different measures to allow tenants to know and use their rights. And that can happen both at national and government level in terms of information firstly, but also particularly sort of advice and support for tenants. And then, as we've already sort of referred to, it's proper resourcing for local authorities to enforce. But alongside that, sharing of best practice, improved data, so for local authorities to know what's going on in their areas, and sharing of that data, and also sort of ensuring that skills gaps are addressed in terms of like local authorities' ability to recruit effective staff, and obviously as well renter sort of ability to access justice through the tribunal, I think, could be dramatically improved. And a lot of what our research has shown is that the tribunal is very, very difficult to access for renters. And also it's worth noting that not just renters, but landlords also find the tribunal very difficult to deal with. I don't know if you wanted to add anything on what the evidence has shown, Anna.
No, really, just repeating what I've said before. It is about enabling tenants to assert their rights. They need the knowledge. So at the basic level, there needs to be, you know, a public campaign about informing tenants about what their rights are. I mean, one example in interviewing tenants is that one tenant gave, and it was a recommendation from a previous wave, actually, but one tenant this wave in 2024 said that their letting agent had given them a verbal walkthrough on what their rights and responsibilities were and those of the landlord at the beginning of the tenancy, which actually you see a lot of in social rented sector, and they found that really valuable. And other tenants that we spoke to said, oh, they thought would be a really good thing. So you can't, you know, just produce a huge wad of paper and expect people to read through it and understand it. A verbal walkthrough so that people understand their rights and responsibilities. So there's information and knowledge right from the start. But that there are resources there for people to access that support and information and advice if they need to. So, you know, the likes of Citizens Advice, other independent bodies where they can go to without fear of recrimination and enable them to assert their rights. But I say again that the market is a powerful backdrop to everything. So even if you have those that knowledge and know what your rights are, but you know that there's no affordable alternative, so the focus still needs to be on increased supply of affordable rented housing.
Okay, Deborah and then Alex.
Just very briefly, if you look at the success of, oh my goodness, I've forgotten his name, but the guy who's been, you know, showing up social housing down south where there are terrible conditions, or you look at the success of Living Rent, for example, there's something about bringing really bad practice out into the open, which can also help protect tenants, which I think is one lesson I've learned over the last couple of years. I think they've been phenomenally successful at sort of walking alongside people in the way that Anna is talking about individual landlords doing. And I think that's really important, and that's part of that culture shift that we talked about right at the beginning about this being people's homes and you having a right to expect things. And just final point, Chartered Institute of Housing Scotland talked about the need for a private rented sector charter in the same way as we've got one for social housing, which just sets out the rights and responsibilities of both parties in a really clear way, which I think would also be a really useful step forward.
Alex.
Thank you. Yeah, that last point, I think, that point about a charter and clarity and digestibility. I suppose the only point I wanted to add, which we touched on something Deborah made earlier on, so Cash did a little bit of work a little while ago about ADR or dispute resolution in the private rented sector, but quite a lot of interesting things going on in sort of digital space about how to streamline some of these processes, how to make them more accessible, how to sort of make it less of a burden to engage with the system. So there may well be some things in that sort of area that are worth looking at in terms of adjudication or tribunal access. So some more attention to not only making it simpler in terms of information, but the sort of, I was going to say, customer journey through that system, you know, as a way of trying to at least reduce barriers, if not get people to fully engage.
Okay, I think that's going to bring our questions to a conclusion. I think it's been very helpful to hear from you this morning. And before I suspend, I'm going to invite Mark Griffin to declare his interest.
Thank you. Apologies, Convener. I should have declared that interest before my contribution, just to let members know that I was previously an owner of a private rented property in North Lanarkshire Council area up until July last year.
Thanks, Mark. And as I said, now I briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a change of witnesses. I now welcome our second panel of witnesses to the meeting. We're joined by Lindsay Cleland, who's the Policy Officer at Age Scotland, Dan Wilson Craw, who is the Deputy Chief Executive at Generation Rent, Aoife Deary, who is the Senior Social Justice Policy Officer at the Citizen Advice Scotland, Ellie Gormersall, who's the President at the National Union of Students Scotland, Ellie Kay, who is a tenant of a rented property, and Emma Saunders, who's the National Organiser at Living Rent. And we're going to turn to questions just to let you know that there's no need for you to operate your microphones. We'll do that for you. I've got a couple of kind of general opening questions. And the first one is that I think we'd be interested to hear your thoughts on the fact that the Scottish Government states that the bill contains a package of reforms which will help ensure people have a safe, secure and affordable place to live. And I'd just be interested to hear, in general, your thoughts on to what extent the bill will deliver those aims. And anyone can, who would like to go first? I pick on someone. Okay, Ailey and then Aoife.
Hi, good morning. Thank you again for inviting Living Rent to come give evidence. We obviously welcome the bill, especially tenants across Scotland who have campaigned for this for the past 10 years. And we believe it is an entirely proportional and necessary response to both Scotland's recently declared housing emergency, but more so for the Scottish Government to meet its Housing to 2024 vision, its child poverty reduction targets, and its ambitious human rights vision as well. It's really important to clarify that tenants bear the brunt of this emergency. Over the past, roughly the past decade, rents have increased by 51.99%. since 2010. Obviously, this has local specificities. So this is far above CPI inflation in Greater Glasgow, in Lothian, where rents have increased by, on average, 80%. This is all the while in the backdrop of stagnated wages, increasing energy bills, increasing childcare costs, fuel costs as well. Just for comparison, back in 1980, when we had rent controls, private tenants were spending about 10% of their income. Obviously, this is now an average of 30%, and this increases for lower-income earners. If we're going to compare that to homeowners, they spend roughly 8% of their income on their mortgage. Specifically, since the cost of living crisis and, you know, despite the emergency protections, we've seen landlords use every loophole that they can to increase rent. So it's really important when we're speaking about this bill that not only we speak about its intent, but also learn the lessons from the emergency legislation to close those loopholes. I watched the previous session and there was some really valuable discussion about data and implementation, but what's quite concerning is that we've not talked about the human cost of an unregulated PRS. And we've got a quote from one of our members that I think is really quite important to read out. Actually, in choosing this quote, there was almost too many to choose from, and that shouldn't be the case, but anyways. Over the last 2 years, I have faced three successive rent increases, bringing my rent up to £1,400 a month, which is well over 50% of my income. I am unable to afford this. Despite writing a personal plea to the landlord, he has stated that he's not willing to negotiate another increase. I'm a single parent with full-time care of my child. For the last 4 years, this house has been our home. We take care of it, we love it, and we have built a community here. My child is currently awaiting the final stages of an assessment for both autism and ADHD, and uprooting them at this time would be incredibly difficult. We'd lose our support network we've built here. I'm petrified of being forced out of a home because we simply cannot meet the requested yearly rent increases. That being said, and I mentioned that there's obviously loopholes to work through, and I hope that the discussion later on we can adjust those, but we particularly welcome many aspects of the bill, such that the provision regarding rent control related to the property rather than the tenancy, the ability for rent control areas to cover the whole local authority, again, something learned from rent pressure zones. Yeah. We welcome the 0% potential cap because rents need to go down. They can't just be stabilised. We also would like to mention that we're concerned, particularly this is something that we've seen from our members, that this bill doesn't go far enough to cover rent increases within social and council tenancies, particularly for rent increases within those types of tenancies on top of service charges. So we've had one member face a 16% total increase just this year between social tenant increase in service charges. It's also disappointing to see that this bill fails to include any measures to address the extensive disrepairs and quality issues faced by tenants, such as mould and damp, energy inefficiency, and general disrepair. Lastly, the bill fails to review the grounds of evictions and, moreover, any improvement to the eviction process. This would be entirely necessary to prevent what is a growing culture of de facto no-fault evictions. Despite this, we really want to maintain and reiterate that this bill is absolutely essential, again, for addressing the housing emergency, and it's very much welcome. And we look forward to discussing it today to improve it. Thank you.
Great. Thanks very much for that. And I know, Aoife, you're going to come in, but I just want to say, so my first question was kind of like general comments on the extent to which the bill delivers the aims of the stated government's aims of safe, secure and affordable place to live. And then I have a second question, which Ailey started to touch on. So I'm going to put it into the mix so you can pick that up as well, which is about the overall how well you think the bill balances the rights of tenants and the rights of landlords. So I'm going to add that and we can cover that. Aoife.
Thank you, and thank you for having us along to share our evidence with committee this morning. Yes, Citizens by Scotland welcomes the introduction of the bill. We believe it goes some way towards improving the housing experiences and the outcomes of renters in particular. It was mentioned in the previous panel, though, that there's a need to take landlords along in this process too, and I'll come back to that later in the session with some particular detail on that. So we believe that the bill is needed, and this is because everyone in Scotland should have a safe, secure and sustainable home. Research has consistently found the foundational importance of a home to people's well-being, to building communities, reducing health inequalities and, as highlighted in Housing to 2040, improving overall life chances. We think, and our evidence shows, that rents in some area are simply too high, and it is justified that government intervention happens. We know that people are increasingly struggling to access a home, especially those who are on low incomes, and so we need to help people access and remain in their homes and develop proportionate evidence-based policies to limit high rent increases, which is what the bill seeks to do in quite a careful way, I'd say. And I think there's also a strong need for better data, enforcement against poor practice and additional resources, which I know others have spoken about. But for us at CAS, they're the golden threads that weave throughout this bill that really need to be examined, because they're going to be critical to this legislation getting it right and delivering those outcomes for both renters and landlords. And lastly, just to wrap up, I would just say that the bill is particularly important because the cost of living crisis is not over. People are still feeling the effects of it. In quarter four of this year, compared to last year, we saw a 23% increase in people seeking housing-related cost of living advice. So this is around rents, rent increases, but also mortgage arrears for landlords. So that shows that the cost of living crisis has not ended. People are still feeling the effects, and what this bill aims to do should help with some of that.
Thanks. Ali.
Yeah, thank you for having us along to give our evidence on behalf of NUS Scotland. Naturally, most of my evidence will relate specifically to the student experience of housing. With regards to that stated aim of a safe, secure and affordable place, we believe that that's absolutely essential for all tenants. But unfortunately, there are parts of this bill that do not cover many students. And we welcome the bill overall, particularly with regards to bringing in rent controls for those in the private rented sector. But one of our real concerns is that among the student population, a lot of students don't live in the private rented sector, they live in purpose-built student accommodation, PBSA, and this bill doesn't touch on PBSA at all. And what that will do is that will create a disparity between students and other tenants. And students are a population who desperately need support when it comes to housing, desperately need safe, secure and affordable places to live. Research from NUS Scotland from the end of 2022 found that 12% of students in Scotland have been homeless at some point during their studies. That's a horrifying statistic. A lot of that involves students struggling to find somewhere that they can afford to live at the start of term. And 35% of students have been unable to pay their rent in full. And when we speak to students on the ground about their challenges with finding somewhere that's safe, secure and affordable to live, it's often the fact that the places that are on the market are simply out with the financial ability for a student to pay. From 2018 to 2021, the average annual rent of purpose-built student accommodation in Scotland increased by 34%. And for the average student receiving the average amount of cost of living support through SAS, for instance, paying the average rent in purpose-built student accommodation, 84% of that student's rent will be going, 84% of that student's income, sorry, will be going to rent. So, well, I won't repeat the excellent points made by other panellists around the reasons why we welcome this bill and some of our concerns with regards to the private rented sector. We think it's critical that the bill goes further to make sure that all tenants are protected. This is particularly important as well in terms of, I heard from the previous panel, there were some chats around people knowing what their rights are and being aware of what their rights are. This is a particular challenge for students, many of whom it's the first time that they've ever lived independently. And when you add into the mix the fact you've got these different housing sectors that different students might be living in with very different sets of rights, one PBSA, which has significantly fewer rights than the private rented sector, that becomes a challenge too. And the final thing that I'll just add with regards to the second part of your question around balancing the rights of tenants with the rights of landlords, naturally we represent students and we see the scourge, as I say, 12% of students having experienced homelessness during the course of their studies. And I think it's just important for us to keep in mind throughout this conversation that when a landlord is unable to make, say, their mortgage payments, for instance, or that's, you know, that their business is failing, the worst case scenario for them is that they lose part of their property portfolio. For a student or a tenant who is unable to afford their rent, the worst case scenario for them is homelessness. And I think it's important for us to bear that in mind when we're talking about balancing those rights. Thanks.
Okay. Thanks, Ellie, and thanks for bringing in the perspective of the NFUS and the fact that the student accommodation isn't covered in this bill at the moment. Anybody else? Dan.
So basically our homes are the foundations of our lives and it's a basic need. It having a stable, secure, safe, affordable home is essential to all our lives. It shouldn't be making us ill or poorer. In fact, you know, having control over your home, it means that you've got control over your life. So I think a lot of the problems we see in throughout the UK, it's better in Scotland. Scotland's far ahead of the UK in terms of policy. We still see a lot of barriers to tenants actually feeling that control over their home. Renters don't currently have protection from being priced out of their home by landlords seeking to maximise rent. In Scotland, there are, obviously, we've had the cap and the new transitional arrangements, so we'll see how that plays out. But it's really important in the bill that we have a system of regulating rents that can be relied upon by tenants and provide a bit of certainty for the wider housing system. So that's very welcome. Renters also need to be able to move easily if they need to be able to stay in their communities, and I think the bill goes a long way towards that, to making sure that that rents in the wider market are stable as well. There are a lot of other measures within the bill which we support, but there's some areas where we think that security, safety in private rented homes could be improved. So where a landlord is selling up or moving back in, tenants need more protection, more ability to stay in their home if possible, or if they move, the ability to find a new place easily. We need to make sure that landlords can't misuse grounds easily. We think that's very common. And there are other areas that, that could be addressed in the bill, like improving the deposit protection system and the way laws around safety and the quality of homes can be enforced. Tenants need to have better awareness of what their rights are, but then also the actual ability to exercise those rights.
Thanks very much. We're going to definitely get into detail around deposits and other aspects. Lindsay, I think you wanted to come in.
Thank you, Committee, for having us along today. At Age Scotland, we're the national charity for over 50s in Scotland, and we very much welcome the overall aims of the bill in order to make sure that the private rented sector is safe, secure, accessible and a suitable tenure for all, but particularly in later life. Our research has noted that there's an increasing number of people who are over 50 moving into the private rented sector. In the last 2 years alone, that number had doubled up to 12% from our most recent housing research. And that's only going to increase as the number of younger people in the private rented sector tend to remain there longer and may never actually move on to the property market of owning their own property. With our ageing population as well, Scotland's population is ageing faster than the rest of the UK. So it's very important that we ensure that the private rented sector is something that's suitable for all stages of life. With regards to rent controls, what we do know from research from Independent Age as well is that 39% of older renters are living in poverty, many of whom are probably in the 24% of older households that are experiencing extreme fuel poverty. So there's compounding levels of financial stress within older households who are renting. When coming talking about rights and awareness that was touched upon, our own research tells us that worryingly 42% of older people that were in the private rented sector didn't know what rights they had. A quarter of them didn't even know what tenancy type they had, never mind being able to then use those rights and utilise them and enact them when it comes to things like rent adjudication or challenging their landlord over a rent increase. For older people as well, they've often been in their home for a certain period of time. They've built their community, they set up access to care at home in their local area, their local GP, which makes moving to somewhere different a lot more challenging and a lot more complex. So they're often stuck in a rock and a hard place almost of, I can't afford to pay this rent, but it would be so difficult and so complex to move elsewhere that it becomes, they stay in unsuitable housing tenure for their needs. Other parts of the bill that we particularly welcome as well, kind of touches on that, and the suitable housing aspect is the changes to let property and the rights of tenants to be able to make those changes, and we can discuss it a bit more in questions later, but we would really like to see some more clarity around that so that we can ensure that tenants are have the right and the ability to make sure that their home is suitable and adaptable for them as they age over time.
And just in terms of the balance of the bill, the bill balancing the rights of tenants with the rights of landlords, do you have a sense of that?
I think we have to kind of look at the bigger context in that what where the balance is currently, and perhaps that the balance is potentially a bit skewed towards landlords at the moment, particularly when it comes to things like being able to make changes to property, energy efficiency measures and things like that, and which this bill seeks to address and bring back in to balance. I think the bill itself also provides a lot of clarity and consistency for both landlords and tenants around rights, responsibilities, what should be expected of your home and your property. So the bill actually does go some way into managing expectations more more clearly for both sides. We obviously represent older tenants and older landlords as well, and often older landlords similarly are unaware of the responsibilities that they have in terms of delivering suitable and affordable housing. So this bill will seek to address that as well.
Okay, great. We're going to move on to rent. We're going to talk about rent. I'm going to bring in Pam Gosol with a couple of questions.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Thank you very much for coming along. What's your views on the rent control area provisions in the bill? And is the process for declaring a rent control area sufficiently clear? And do you think it will lead to rent stabilisation in the affected areas?
We'd like to pick that up first.
So what are the views on the rent control area provision of the bill? Mm-hmm. And is the process for declaring a rent control area sufficiently clear, obviously, in the bill? And do you think it will lead to rent stabilisation in the affected areas? So will rent stabilise, really?
Sure, yeah, that's a really great question. I think the provisions of rent controls are really important and we're very glad to see them. And that ability to cover the whole local authority is hugely important, and also having that localised aspect. As we know, the entirety of Scotland is a housing emergency, but it does have local specificities, particularly in relation to the Highlands and Islands, Edinburgh and Glasgow area. That, in order to implement the rent control area, one of the lessons perhaps learnt from the RPZs that were introduced in the 2016 Act is that the data collection is really important. So we would like to see this introduced with measures to, one, fund councils properly to do that data collection implementation, but also we should be important of, you know, that this bill is quite political and all tenants in Scotland deserve protection from unstable rent increases. So again, having ministers allowing to designate an RPZ where a local authority wouldn't necessarily agree with it is really important, because it should be based on data, not the politics of it. Do you have anything to add?
If I may. Thank you, convener. Yeah, just to add, I think what's very, very important in this provision, and it goes a long way to address some of the loopholes we've seen in the emergency protection measures, is in between tenancy increases. And that is really, really important, so that we don't have the hikes of new market rents that we have been experiencing, and our members have been experiencing, but also so that there is no incentive or perverse incentive to have evictions, because that, again, has been one of the sad sort of unintended consequences of having protections, is that landlords then try to evict you. I think in terms of the making the process clear, making sure that tenants have access to that data as well. So right now in the bill, it's local authorities who will have access to rents. But if landlords lie or don't provide data, it would be very, very important for tenants to be able to look at their rents and look at the database and see, oh, there is a mismatch here, I need to report that, so that we can empower tenants to also implement the law. And that the sort of the last bit of it as well is just having a measure that stabilises and or brings down rents. So at the moment, rents are unaffordable. And if we do want to provide affordable rents in Scotland, stabilising and decreasing rents is necessary, especially in specific areas.
Aoife.
Thank you for that question. Yes, there is a need to make rent changes to the renting system in Scotland. As I've said before, a lot of people approach Bureau for advice because they're having problems accessing or sustaining a home for affordability reasons. Just to illustrate this as well, advice on rents makes up about 10% of all private rented sector advice we give out. So it's our second highest area of PRS advice. Advice on actual homelessness due to rent levels or rent increases rose by 35% in quarter four of this year compared to last year. And the Scottish Government's own PRS statistics indicated that rents have grown substantially. I think you'd referred to the ONS stats earlier, 16%. I think Scottish Government says about 14% based on advertised rents. So it's clear that rents are rising at an unsustainable rate. And for this reason, our view of the measures in the bill is that they're necessary, but it does need to be, again, proportionate and evidence-led as this goes forward, and responsive to local circumstances as well. In terms of the process, I think it's quite clear. It does try and take in the local experience quite robustly. However, I think there's a real need for quite a lot more resources for local authorities to be carrying out the data collection that's really needed to create the report that they need to send to Scottish ministers for their consideration. I won't repeat the points that have been made already, but particularly around awareness, we would echo that. And I think you'd asked as well about rent stabilisation. I think you heard from Professor Gibb earlier, who's written a paper which includes that there's international evidence that in areas that have rent control around the world, including Germany and Sweden, that there's evidence of rent stabilisation, or at least the rent market isn't adversely affected, I think is the proper wording, when there's clarity and stability for landlords and investors. So there's international evidence that the market doesn't just break, I suppose, when rent controls are introduced, and it can be done well.
Okay, thanks. Lindsay, you indicated you want to come in.
Yes, I won't repeat any of the points. We fully agree with what's been said already, but around the kind of necessary measures for rent controls and the need for the kind of careful design around this, our own research showed that even when there were protections in place over COVID, around 37% of older private renters had had a rent increase, which really highlights the need for the closing of those loopholes between in-between tenancies and the need to design this carefully so that landlords aren't incentivised to raise rents at different periods where they can, and to make sure that there's stakeholder work with a range of different groups on where protections need to be and where there are likely to be rent increases out with that. On the need for stabilisation, I think, as you said, it will provide clarity and consistency for landlords on what to expect, so that might also stabilise rents. One of the concerns we did have was around the ability for local authorities to designate rent control areas within their own local authority, and that how that might add to the complexity and the length of time it takes for measures to be implemented, but also increase housing demand in certain areas. Local authorities are already struggling with social housing demand, increasing homelessness applications, so perhaps a more local authority-wide approach could provide better stability to the housing market and to rental costs in the area. But that's something that could be discussed in kind of secondary design.
And then Dan.
Thank you. Again, I won't repeat anything that's already been said other than to say that I strongly agree with all of the points that have already been made. The thing that I would add is that some of the consequences of the fact that these rent control areas will not include purpose-built student accommodation, particularly in local areas where there's a high number of students, you know, where there's either universities or multiple universities often, is that I have a real concern that when there's then a massive disparity between the two different types of accommodation, particularly when you consider the fact that students often are all looking for accommodation around the same time of year, then that actually destabilises the entire piece, because if you've got a huge number of students who are looking for accommodation, you've got the private rented sector, which rightly has rent control, rent control area implemented, but then you've got purpose-built student accommodation, which doesn't. Potentially students might initially then be looking at the private rented sector rather than purpose-built student accommodation, which will obviously have an impact on all tenants. But then eventually what will happen is that there will still be students who need places to live, so they'll be forced into purpose-built student accommodation because there's no other option. And one of the really worrying things here is that the way that a lot of purpose-built student accommodation providers set their rents, it's more akin to how like airlines or concerts sell tickets, you know, this sort of surge pricing, which is pretty abhorrent, where you might have multiple students living in the same building, in exact same identical rooms. Someone has booked it earlier when there's more availability, so they get a cheaper rate, and then closer to when term starts, for instance, when you've got, you know, students maybe getting late admission, etc., or you know, who just haven't been able to find somewhere else to live, they get charged significantly more. And as I say, when you then have that completely unregulated sector mixed into the bunch where you've got then private rented sector as well, that has a knock-on impact to the wider population too. So I think this is one of those reasons why it's really important that these measures, with the notes made by other people, that they apply to all forms of tenancy in a particular area.
Okay, Dan.
Yes, everyone said a lot that I agree with. Well, I'd like to emphasise just how much of a lottery the private rented sector is. So as a tenant, you when you're looking for a home, you're taking a gamble on whoever owns that property. Sometimes they'll be a really considerate landlord who values you as a tenant and someone who's a custodian of their property and won't raise the rent every year to the maximum possible, then or you could find yourself with a landlord who all they care about is getting the maximum financial return out of the property, and people don't need that when it's their home, that it's costing them potentially 40-50% of their income, and a rent increase will be devastating for their finances. The emergency rent cap helped with that. It meant that everyone could expect some basic protection. Clearly, that was an emergency piece of legislation. We need a more sustainable sort of long-term replacement for that. And the bill's really helpful in doing that and setting out the terms in which we can introduce regulation in certain areas. It also recognises the need that we need stability between tenancies as well, and works that into the system. In terms of what the outcome will be in terms of stability, there is a lot of detail that we will have to wait for in terms of regulations. The discretion of the minister will be important as well. So there are things that are unclear at this stage. What we'd like to see is some. There clearly needs to be a metric of capping rent increases that reflects affordability, what tenants can actually afford. What we'd like to see is no rent increases that are higher than the rate of wage growth or consumer price inflation, which is are both sort of reasonable measures of what tenants can afford. We'd like to see more detail on that in the bill. It's really obviously really important about data collection, as some of colleagues on the panel have mentioned. And there's a big question of how transparent that is, how can the landlord register be used and integrated with this system, just so that the public, renters and anyone else who's interested can actually see whether data is being collected, whether it does reflect reality, and whether local authorities are getting the best data that they need to make decisions and recommendations. That's fine. That's all I have.
A little bit there, so because Pam has another question, we've got a lot more questions, 12 questions, and we've got an hour. And there's quite a few of you, so I'm going to just appeal to all of us to do a bit of collective time management. So, colleagues, you know what that means a bit there. Pam, do you want to come in and ask? And I think maybe only one person really needs to answer the next question you've got around the rent control area.
Yeah, thank you, convener. I think some of you have answered some of these questions, but if you can add to it, some of the detail on how that rent control area will work in practice has still to be decided. For example, we do not know much about the way in which rent increase might be, the rent increase might be limited, which properties that might be exempt, and about the circumstances in which higher rents might be charged. So, what are your views around that, and what approach should be taken on these issues?
Anybody? Yeah. I don't want to stifle off responses, but. Okay, Dan.
Exemptions. So there's, in terms of the quality of the property and whether a landlord has improved the property, I think there is a reasonable discussion to be had about what kind of exemption is permitted there. I think one thing that we'd be concerned about is whether a tenant who's in a substandard property at the very start and is maybe paying a rent that is a regulated rent that they can barely afford, or maybe their LHA is barely covering. There's a question of whether it's fair that an improvement in the quality of that property then translate into a rent increase that tenant then can't afford. Mm. That's just maybe a question that would be good to address in the bill.
Okay, great. I think Lindsay, yeah, and then I think Emma.
Yes, just
in terms of the exemption, one of the kind of proposals that we'd put in a written submission could be around, you know, flexibility within the caps around the state and quality of the home, energy efficiency rating, energy efficiency measures that are in there. So that could provide a level of flexibility for landlords to kind of recover costs and encourage them also to maintain the quality of their home, to implement energy efficiency measures that would benefit them and the tenant. But also we do have that concern around betterment almost, and there needn't to be protection in the bill for tenants who perhaps make changes to their home, which does put the value up, but that then cannot be used to increase rents or as an exemption for the property to be from the rent control zones.
Thanks. Emma?
Very briefly, yes, in terms of quality, we think it's really important to be able to consider that in deciding sort of the maximum rent increase, whether that be because the quality is actually very good or whether that be the quality is very bad. And increasingly, we are seeing our members reporting rent increases despite having mould, damp, broken boilers, etc. And that feels like a double burden. In terms of that sort of, as Dan was saying, capping it around wage inflation or CPI and having a maximum cap is really important, just in terms of that security. And then in terms of exemption, that is something we're really concerned about because it will create loopholes. And so that will distort the house building market, potentially distorting it in favour of purpose-built student accommodation, which might not be the type of housing that we need in a city. It might also distort the existing PRS market, and especially in the case of joint tenancies or sort of if there's something about specifically students. Suddenly, what happens if you go back to university and you're in a tenancy, etc.? So that creates a massive, massive uncertainty, nightmare and insecurity. So that's something we would be really, really concerned about doing and would advise a lot of caution around any exemption.
And circumstances for higher rents. Obviously, we've heard having that balance, landlords and tenants. Landlords have talked about their insurance is dearer, their mortgage rates are higher. So do you think that's one of the areas that higher rents could be charged or not?
Yeah, I think that's obviously an interesting question, but I think it also speaks to the question that Ariane posed earlier about balancing needs. There isn't very good data on this because it's obviously not collected, but I would struggle to say that a landlord who has paid off their mortgage, who is facing an increase in insurance, is the same that as a tenant who's faced a rent increase, who's struggling to put food on the table. So I think we kind of need to zoom out and try to actually find balance in what is the most pressing issue. It would be a good exercise for the Scottish Government to actually collect that data on what the actual costs faced by landlords. But I think increasingly what we're seeing with this discussion about rent controls is that it's kind of ignoring what's also happening to tenants, so such as fuel, bills increasing rapidly, and there's no incentive for landlords to make the property more energy efficient. So I think it has to be given in consideration to the wider problems faced by tenants and landlords. But again, if I think this was spoken about on the previous panel in relation to evictions about the kind of burden of proof on landlords. I think if there was consideration of exemption to rent cap, it has to be a very tight mechanism where the landlord is required to prove to the tribunal essentially that they can justify it. Because what we're seeing with the current system is that landlords are saying costs have gone up, then they're getting exemptions to evictions or to the rent adjudication process, but that's actually not true. So I think if it were to be implemented away, the kind of the burden of proof really has to be on the landlord, and it has to be a very tight system to ensure that it's not a loophole. Okay.
Yeah. Thanks, Pam. I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey because we're going to continue this theme. So don't worry, we're still in that space. Willie, do you want to come in with your question?
Thanks very much, Convener, and hello, everybody. I just wanted to get a few words from you on the protections issue. I mean, other than the obvious, the whole bill is to protect against excessive rent increases, but there are some other protections proposed in there. For example, landlords have to advertise that a property is in a rent control area and things like that. But could you maybe offer a flavour of whether you think there are sufficient protections in there, or could you even suggest what further protections we may actually need to include? How about Lindsay?
short stuff. No, I think the measures within the bill do go some way into providing protections for tenants, let people make more informed decisions about their housing choices in future, particularly if we're looking at older individuals who are perhaps moving into the private rented sector for the very first time. They've maybe owned their home, but now due to financial need, downsizing, mobility needs, are having to look into somewhere else, and the only suitable properties available to them are in the private rented sector. Having that information available on what previous rent has been, what their rates are, what their landlord's responsibilities are, that kind of virtual walkthrough of what they can expect and what and how they can enact their rights and access, it would be extremely helpful for older tenants. Where it may fall down slightly, or where we believe the bill could go further, would be placing responsibility on letting agencies as well. A lot of it talks about duties on landlords to provide accurate information and for local authorities to then check that, but there's little mention of kind of third parties or letting agencies who do the majority of the work for landlords who may have multiple properties. Where would the enforcement be there around? Are they giving out accurate information, and then what would be the penalty if not, and what would be the process if they were not doing that?
Okay, thanks for that. And Nelson, protections that perhaps would enhance the bill, really?
Yeah, I'll just come in very, very briefly around some of the protections stuff there. When these protections are in place, it's really, really important that they're able to be enforced effectively too. And this is something that I think we see a lot of challenges, even with existing rights and protections that tenants have, is that they do exist in law, but the reality is that the enforcement and the ability for a tenant to challenge that, it's such a lengthy, torn-out process, and often with actually very, very low penalties for landlords. So just one example, actually, in this bill, which we have concerns about, is that when you've got landlords, for instance, who increase rent above the cap in a rent control area, there's a potential fine of £1,000. But actually, that's when we're talking about the context of a landlord charging significantly higher rent, many landlords may see that as a risk worth taking because the penalty is relatively low. Similarly, when we've got landlords, for instance, who are illegally evicting tenants, we feel that the penalty for that is that they should be banned from the landlord register. If they're evicting tenants illegally, there should be the penalty for that should reflect the severity of what they're doing. So I think it's important when we're talking about protections that tenants have that we're also talking about the enforcement. And, you know, I know students anecdotally who have made it all the way through to the sort of third tier tribunal for, you know, severe problems, you know, rats and fly infestations in their property, but the process for that has been so drawn out, and then even when they were actually awarded compensation, even then getting that compensation has been a long drawn out challenge. So we have to make sure that protections are actually enforced.
Okay, thank you.
I'm going to ask Dan and Emma, who have indicated they wanted to respond.
Thanks. I think one of the concerns, one of the things that will remain a risk for tenants under a rent control area would be the landlord trying to evict them potentially to sell the property is potentially a big part of it. I think the fact that they wouldn't be able to charge a much higher rent in the new with a new tenant is a helpful protection. What we need in cases where the tenant's being evicted for sale or the landlord moving back in is a much better support if they're having to move. So we'd like to see longer notice periods for at least 4 months. At the moment, there's 3 months or 1 month, even if you're unlucky to be in the first 6 months of the tenancy. We'd like to see relocation relief. So, for example, waiving the last 2 months' rent to allow the tenant to find a new place to live, put down a deposit and the first month's rent. We also need to make sure that the notices aren't being misused, the grounds for eviction aren't being misused. So what we'd suggest, what we'd love to see is for landlords to have to lodge an eviction notice, you know, register an eviction notice with the landlord register, and then that could be part of the evidence for you know, following up later on. Have they moved in? Have they sold the property? And that could help the authorities really understand whether these grounds for eviction are being used properly, and go after landlords who are misusing them.
And then Ava.
Yeah, very quickly, I'll try and make them brief. One of the key things to make it work is that in-between tenancy protection, in-between tenancy rent increase protections. So if there's not that, we will see more evictions. So that is a key aspect to keep to protect tenants. The other thing is around access to data, and it's a bit of repetition, but if tenants can't access that data, they won't be able to claim their rights. They will have less protections. Things to improve, as Ellie was saying, enforcements and penalties will be really, really crucial, whether that be about non-compliance around data or around giving higher rent increases. It should also be having sort of greater protections against revenge evictions. So one of the things we've seen in this period with rent adjudication is if people contest their rent increase, which is their right, they're receiving revenge evictions. And so really having a provision in this bill, whether that be both around rent controls or rent adjudication, so that when you're contesting a rent increase, you have almost like a grace period where you can't be evicted. Otherwise, you won't be able to use your right. And I guess the last thing is also seeing where to improve the legislation, for instance, around compulsory purchase orders, compulsory sales orders, or first right to a refusal by the local authority, so that if the eviction is about a landlord wanting to sell, that a local authority can purchase that property. That makes a lot of sense in terms of new builds and sort of existing builds being at the moment almost the same cost, bringing social and council housing stock quickly back, but also just protecting that tenant from eviction.
Okay.
And Ava.
Just briefly to follow up, colleagues echo the points that have been made, and just to really reinforce that protections are useless without enforcement and proper enforcement. We see time and time again through clients who come to Bureau for advice that local authorities don't have the resources to enforce their rights, or if they other forms of redress, like going through the first tier tribunal, it's long, it's complex. We've talked about this before. It's not particularly user friendly. We have extensive evidence of illegal evictions. We published a report last year exploring the depth and scale and experiences of people who used our services who'd experienced illegal eviction, and it continues to happen at an astonishing rate, really. And it was talked about as well around rent increases. So if I could really briefly just share a case study to really illustrate the impact on people when enforcement doesn't work and protections fail, I suppose. So a bureau in the east of Scotland recently worked with a client we'll call Michael, it's not his real name, who was issued in February this year with a rent increase notice of 40% of his current rent, around £200. This was during the rent cap period. The landlord stated that as the government weren't allowing increases this high, they wanted to find a way around this. They then subsequently sent the client a text to say that they intended to serve him with notice to quit, but that if he was willing to pay the proposed increase, they would offer the flat to him under a new agreement. If not, they would be asking him to vacate the property with a view to selling at the higher price, or sorry, re-advertising it at a higher rate. The client disagreed with the rent increase and has since received a notice to quit using the grounds of the landlord wishes to sell, which is circumventing the proper procedure. The local council has said that if Michael finds somewhere else privately, they will help with the first month's rent, help with the deposit and removals costs. But Michael has tried and cannot find alternative accommodation in his local area and is finding it very difficult. And the local authority has said that social housing would be out of the question given the very long local waiting lists.
Thanks very much for that. Very much sounds like blackmail to me, if want of a better word. Could I just ask my other question, please, on the data collection issue? It's been discussed widely at the previous panel and this panel too. Are we intending to collect the right amount of data at local authority level? Do we need more? Do we need less? Will it allow us to shape the policy better locally? And I think both Lindsay and Emma had said that they were a bit concerned about possible penalties for non-compliance with collection of data locally. I wonder if you could maybe expand on that. But firstly, on the data itself, are we collecting and intending to collect the right data, Hayley?
Obviously, collecting the rent levels is hugely important, not just for this policy, but so that we can all have a greater understanding of how our rent levels in Scotland change over time. But I think when we're talking about rent controls, there's obviously other things that we can look to signify the that would necessitate the area. So things like food bank referrals, uptake and advice from different groups. Like wage stagnation is obviously hugely important. Rents continue to increase, but a lot of workers face real-term wage cuts. So I think when we look to collect the data, we can seek beyond just the rent levels. The second part of your question, what was it again? Sorry.
It was really about penalties for non-compliance with collecting the data that we require. Should there be
So from my understanding, the non-compliance is the £1,000 because obviously it has to be the civil fine, but again, I think this was really well spoken about by Ellie, is that that's not going to disincentivize bad practice from landlords because they can recuperate the costs. What we've seen through a number of members come to us with unfair or illegal rent increases or illegal rent evictions is that during the costs of Living Act, with that potential to recuperate 36 months rent in the tribunal, we use that against landlords and that actually got them to back down. So in terms of the fine, it's really important that it disincentivises bad practice as well, and that also empowers tenants to actually use their rights properly, because we know that tenants, if it's only £1,000, they're not going to fight it because they know that landlord will recuperate the costs and they can do so readily. But if it's something that would completely put landlords off acting unlawfully, then it emboldens tenants to actually uphold their rights as well.
Okay, thanks very much for that. Any other points on data collection, Dan?
Yeah, I really echo that point. It's really helpful to give tenants an incentive to scrutinise their landlord. I think one risk I don't know how aware the authorities are about non-compliance with the register. So it says data collection will only take place where landlords are on the register, but if they're not on there in the first place, then they can fly under the radar. And it's not clear that tenants have the incentive to report landlords if they're not on the register. And there's a rent penalty notice that exists, but it's not clear how aware tenants are of that and how effective it is. It is positive that in the bill, the local authority seeking information from tenants is part of that, because that could be a really helpful way just to check that landlords are providing accurate information, and it'll be, I think, important for councils to use that power just to make sure that they're making the right decisions.
Okay, thanks, Dan. Last word from you, Lindsay.
To echo the points that Dan and Ellie have made around the kind of encouraging of tenants to actually use their rights by having meaningful penalties. But in terms of the actual data being collected, I think it's a really good point by Ellie about not just looking at rents and advertised rents, but also using the data that we've already got better and bringing that together. The Scottish Index of Multiple Deprivation, looking at how many households are in the area are on things like the Priority Services Register for your utilities, how many are receiving certain social security payments, and how many of them are living in the private rented sector, average income, and other measures that we already have quite a lot of data on. It's just kind of sitting about different departments and bringing that all together. And as well as things like rent costs and mortgage costs in the area, to provide a better overview of people's actual circumstances beyond just this is the average cost of rent, because as has been mentioned previously, that's not just the only thing that affects people's affordability to pay. And in terms of the penalties and enforcement, the only other thing I would say is in terms of the £1,000 fine, we would agree, you know, the average rent in Glasgow is £1,200, so it's not even a month's rent for a landlord. It's not a massive incentive, but utilising things that we've already got, like the landlord register, and potentially having penalties around you can't operate for X amount of time, on the landlord register or relet your property if you're found to be in breach of that, in addition to fines, might be enough of a disincentive because they can't then recuperate those costs so easily.
Thank you very much, Everdy, for your responses to those.
Okay, thanks. Again, we're just quite tight on time. It's tremendous what you're bringing to us, so it's great. I don't want to restrain it. We do have a number of questions. We've got a few more in the rent area, and just to give you a highlight, we've got a few on the personalisation of homes. We're going to cover joint tenancies a bit later, and then the tenancy deposits, just so you know what's coming. So I'm going to bring in Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks very much, Convener. Very quick question. I'll roll it together. In the previous panel, we heard that the rent adjudication process, there'd only been just over 200 cases since 2017. Why do you think that is, and how do we improve access for tenants? Yep, Adil.
Thank you for that question. It's an area that we're thinking about at the moment. We also see very low numbers of tenants wishing to use the rent adjudication service. Often there's very low awareness until they use an organisation such as us, advice services such as us, and they don't know rent adjudication exists, but the process just puts them off. It's too complex. It's really difficult to do unless you're given specialist advice and support throughout the process. And some people just want their sort of bad experiences to be over, I suppose. They don't want to dig up the past, even if they're old, I suppose. I think I'm getting a bit mixed up with the first year tribunal here and unlawful damages. That was the point I was going to make before. I'll bring it back to rent adjudication, but it's the same issue, really. The process is still complex. There is a particular issue I wanted to raise around the rent adjudication system, that there's a 21-day window to apply, and a lot of our clients find that a difficult window to apply to the service, and to, especially if they're seeking advice or seeking advice from their local authority. It's just a very short window, and it makes it difficult for people to engage with the process.
It should be if it wasn't 21 days.
I suppose that's a bit of a how long's a piece of string sort of thing. I think we should look at other established timeframes and if there's been evaluation done against those, but I couldn't give you a number.
Okay. Anybody else? Yeah, Emma.
So, first of all, I think it has had a numbers of issues, but I do think there's a bit of a culture change that is happening in Scotland, and I think that is important to highlight, is that given that we have been talking about rent controls since 2016, with more or less success, there is increasingly tenants querying their rent after whether they feel able to contest it. That's something else, but already I think the culture has changed. I think agree that it is complex. There is that fear about eviction. We have two people who contested their rent increase and have received evictions in the last month. Both of them have families. It's incredibly stressful to then think that they're going to have to up and end their life. 21 days, too short. And there's no penalties for chancing it. So if a landlord suggests a 40% increase, a 50% increase, the worst they'll get is 12%. They don't get any penalty for putting that amount of stress on the tenant. So there's also very little incentive for the tenant to report it or contest it. And the last thing is just around language and that complexity, especially for tenants who might not speak English as their first language, who have different access needs. It is just a very hard to access process.
Lindsay?
Yes, just to agree with those points made and to add a bit around the access and the language used. As mentioned before, a lot of older people are moving into the sector for the very first time. So there was a point made around increased awareness for people who are renting for the first time, not just older people, but also having available support in person and offline. A lot of the information around what's an affordable rent and what are my rights and how can I get support is online. The most recent Scottish Housing Condition Survey, still about 24% of over 60s have never used the internet. There's even the ones that do use the internet, from our own research, 30% are still not confident in doing it for anything over and above an email or a social media message. So there's a real need for resourcing within local authorities and also third sector organisations who provide advice to be able to give support for that rent adjudication process in person to people that required it, including older people and others with additional needs.
Okay. Thanks very much.
Okay, thanks, Gordon. I'm now going to bring in Miles, continuing on various areas of rent.
I think a lot of the three questions I have, I think, have been answered to some extent, specifically around evictions and some of the issues which the panel wanted to see the bill included. I wanted to ask a specific question, though, with regards to what's not in the bill around extra supported living and extra care housing, as it might be known, and just wondered, maybe this is a question for yourself, Lindsay, if that's something which you think should be in the bill. I know certainly there's key groups in Edinburgh who don't necessarily aren't able to hold down a tenancy. Housing First doesn't necessarily support them, and just wondered for the panel's views on that. That could also go into some student accommodation as well, issues as well. I think Edinburgh University, I met recently, were talking about students with additional support need and the one-size-fits-all model. So just wondered if there's anything the panel wanted to mention on that.
Yeah, I'm happy to start off on that one. Certainly one of our kind of concerns, or maybe where we could like see more clarity in the bill, is around that exemption on type of property. We've talked a bit about purpose-built student accommodation. What about purpose-built accessible accommodation within various sectors? And also, the bill doesn't look at social housing or registered social landlords, where a lot of accessible housing is built. And often we see, while rents are perhaps more affordable, as they're designed to be more affordable, we've heard from older people who are facing increased service charges. So their rent isn't going up, but they're making money from other ways of doing so. So we'd like to see some more protections included for people there, because they're more likely to need adaptations and things.
Yeah, just to come in around students, particularly disabled students, students with additional support needs, a lot of the challenges that those students face are significantly amplified in terms of being able to find somewhere that not only is affordable, but that also meets their accessibility needs. This is another one of the reasons why it's really important that, for instance, purpose-built student accommodation should be included in a rent control scheme, because one of the things that we see at the moment in a lot of purpose-built student accommodation is that they will have an allocation of accessible rooms, but they might have different tiers of rooms. Again, a lot of these purpose-built student accommodation providers, they operate more like hotels in some ways, and so you'll have, you know, the sort of bog standard, there's a bed and a desk room, and then you'll have the more sort of luxury, and I use luxury in deliberate inverted commas there, rooms. And often provision for disabled students in accessible rooms may only be in the luxury rooms, which in their view then justifies an increased cost. So when we're talking about you know, particular adaptations, etc., I would be arguing not only that you know, when we're talking about rent control areas, for example, that applies to student accommodation, but also that there's specific provision in there for the allocation of accessible rooms.
Very briefly, I think just to re-emphasise, that is something we're really seeing in social housing, is increased service charges. So we have had a member face a 400% increase in a service charge this year, which brings their sort of rent and service charge increase to 16% for a person who's retired on a fixed income. That is immense per month. And so there is a concern that this bill doesn't go far enough to provide protections. It's in other places where rent increases are going on that are above what people can afford.
Thanks for that.
Okay, thanks, Miles. We're going to go on to questions around personalisation of a home with Mark Griffin.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Just to ask members of the panel what their views are on the extra rights that are provided within the bill for tenants to personalise their home, what the benefits of that would be, and whether the rights are essentially enforceable in practice. And specifically to Lindsay as well, I wonder if you could expand on your written submission as to how to link those rights with rights to adaptations too. And maybe start with you, Lindsay.
Yeah, so we do welcome these rights. We've talked a little bit in the previous session on this panel about how important it is for tenants to feel at home, to feel settled, to build a place of community, and allowing that personalisation and the right to keep a pet is really important. For our perspective as well, adaptations are really important. Scottish kind of housing strategy is to enable people to remain safely and independently in their own home for as long as possible, and that's what we're also aiming to do. Where we would like to see some clarity in the bill is around what would fall, where would an adaptation fall? Is that a Category 1 or a Category 2 thing? If it's a Category 2, that's a 6-month kind of period you must be in the property before you can apply for that. For some people, it's an urgent need. It's the difference between being able to get out of bed and not get out of bed that day. So they don't have 6 months to wait, and we'd like to see some clarity and consultation with the different stakeholders around how we can ensure the needs of older and disabled people who require something for their health and safety in their home are able to do so without having to wait unreasonable periods of time only for to potentially not get a response and then have to take it up with tribunal. And the same with things like painting a wall was the example given in the bill. That was a Category 2 one, and while that might seem like a kind of nice to have personalisation thing, actually for many older people, particularly those living with like a sight impairment or who are living with dementia, that's a really necessary thing to do in their home to help them navigate safely and effectively to prevent falls and injuries. So there needs to be some provisions kind of within the bill on landlords to look at personal circumstances for each tenant on whether something can be reasonably refused or not in protection for older and disabled tenants, where those are required and not just around feeling at home, which is also really important, but it's also to help their health and safety and their independence.
For people wanted to come in on this one, Aoife, I think you indicated, Dan, and then Ailey and Ellie.
Thank you. Just really briefly, I think the points that have been made by Lindsay are really important. I'd like to provide some supplementary evidence to the committee on adaptations queries that we get, as I haven't got it with me today, if that would be helpful. But just broadly, CAS is supportive of the measures in this area. I think we need to start talking about less about properties and more about homes and where people can build their lives. I talked already about the foundational importance of home to well-being, and I think that the measures afford people the opportunity to make houses into homes, and that's really, really important. The only caution I would make is that potentially this might lead to higher deposits being charged, which would be a barrier to some people accessing accommodation. So I think tenancy deposit schemes have a role to play in this and ensuring that this is done fairly.
Okay. Dan.
Thanks. We're very supportive of this part of the bill. It's control over your home is such an important part of that, you know, building that foundation to your life. And that's just not something tenants have right now. No confidence to really do that, especially if we're moving into an era where renting is not just for people who are going to be moving next year. It's where people are raising their families. So at the moment, not being able to have a pet is something that's kind of makes tenants second-class citizens in a lot of ways. I think there's a couple of things to really bear in mind when designing this, and it's part of it's the transparency of the tribunal and just making sure that people who are asking the landlord to make changes or to keep a pet kind of are aware of the different reasons that the landlords are using and what are being accepted by the tribunal and what aren't. And then there's also a concern that landlords would be able to just ignore requests and then they time out and tenants won't get the answer they want. And that should be looked at.
Thanks very much. Ailey and then Ellie.
Yeah, we really welcome this. I think it's been highlighted that tenants are spending longer in the PRS. It's not just a transitionary place before they buy their first home. People will grow up and live for their entire lives in the private rented sector, so that ability to make a house a home is hugely important. I think one of the concerns that we have is this: we see this all the time with tenants who want to make or have requested disrepair changes, so things like stuff needing done to the property, is that we're worried that landlords will use this as a loophole to get out of their requirements and expectations of keeping the property in good repair, particularly as this bill fails to address any quality measures within the PRS, that oftentimes that if a tenant is, you know, asking for double glazing, for example, that if this regulation isn't laid out extremely clearly, that this could be used by a landlord under a personalisation case where the cost would have to be fixed by the tenant. And that's what we're quite concerned about, that it could provide a loophole for the quality of the property. So what we'd like to see is within the regulations that it is explicitly clear that the repairing standard, one, should be improved, but also that if the tribunal were to receive an application from the tenant on something related out with personalisation, that they would rightly refuse it and then also give the tenant advice and hopefully then allow the local authority to pursue the landlord for failing to keep the property up. That's just an idea, but yeah, we're just worried that it could create a loophole around the quality of the properties.
Good. Thanks for bringing that need for a distinction there, Ellie.
Yeah, thanks, and we'd really echo that important point there around repairs. And when it comes to students, like anyone, where the place where we live is our home as well, and so it's really important that students also have the right to make our where we're living a home. Naturally, when we're talking about, for instance, student accommodation, we might not necessarily be expecting significant changes, especially given the short nature of the tenancy, but actually changes should still be able to be made. For instance, being able to put posters up on the wall, sometimes that gets turned down because of the risk of damage from blue tack that can actually be relatively easily fixed. There was a TikTok trend a few months ago that I saw, and it was comparing, it was a sort of challenge of, is this a student accommodation or is it a Scandinavian prison? Because that's the quality of a lot of student accommodation. And I think that emphasises the point of actually when you've got students who also have very, very severe mental health issues, often the rate of poor student mental health is through the roof. Actually just being able to make the often very cramped small space that you're living in just a little bit more homely can have a huge, huge impact. Similarly, when it comes to pets, again, I think the SPCA would probably have some thoughts if we were suggesting having a dog or a cat in a tiny little student accommodation room. But actually the principle of being able to have pets is also really, really important. So to use myself as an example here, when I was moving to university, I was unable to stay in purpose-built student accommodation. I had to find somewhere in the private rented sector that would let me have my python. And this is the thing, is that actually there's a lot of pets that actually could very reasonably be kept in a student accommodation room that require, you know, little space, for instance, for an enclosure. But actually at the moment, it's a blanket rule of no, you can't at all. So that's something that should be looked at too.
Okay, thanks. Very briefly, Emma.
To add as well, and bringing in the pets element, we heard in the previous panel about mobility, and if you want to enable greater mobility, being able to move with a pet will really, really help, because people are staying in tenancies because they can't find another tenancy which will accept a pet, so that is potentially trapping them in something that's no longer what they want or need, because they can't find another place with pets.
Okay. Okay, I'm going to bring in Lindsay, but we're really
very briefly, yeah. Just and around kind of reasonableness on both changes to property and pets. It'd be really useful for the bill to have clarity for tenants and landlords around kind of what is reasonable, depending on maybe property size or the type of property, just so that people could manage expectations, choose housing appropriately, understand why something's been reasonably refused. And to tie it into the adaptations again, it'd be really useful to tie this into a national adaptation strategy, because I think there's an assumption when it comes to adaptations that it's going to be a ramp up to the door or really big changes to a home, installing a lift, when actually it could be a grab rail in the bathroom that's kind of easily remedied once that tenant moves out, and having a national approach to what adaptations are and how easy and accessible they are to get and remove and to replace would be really beneficial in supporting tenants and landlords to do those things.
Okay, great. Thanks. Mark, I think you've got another question.
Yeah, I've got a question on joint tenancies, specifically for Emma or Ailey. Now, in your submission, you've welcomed the provision how to end a joint tenancy, but I've raised concerns about the impact that has on remaining tenants in a joint tenancy, and that they won't see any benefit. I wonder if you can elaborate and make any suggestions for improvements on the ending of joint tenancies?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm going to repeat the same point I've been saying, but if to have more security in joint tenancy, in between tenancy rent controls will help. And then the second thing is about the remaining tenant having a right to propose another tenant. And so if, again, just it's a terrible comparison, but like you shouldn't have the right to be unreasonably refused proposing another tenant, just like proposing having a pet or proposing a redecoration, especially if they meet all the criterias. That will increase the security of the remaining tenants, but also just from an equalities perspective, that means they have a bit more say over who they live with, which might be very important if they're a more vulnerable tenant, etc.
Okay, Ellie, yeah.
Just very, very briefly on this, joint tenancies, students disproportionately likely to be in joint tenancies. And just adding on to that point, one of the other important factors for students in particular is that if one of the joint tenants moves out, if the person who moves then into that vacancy is not a student, depending on the number of people in that property and the number who are students and not students, that can impact whether or not, for instance, everyone in that property then has to pay council tax. So there's an added factor there for students as well.
Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks for that bit of detail. I'm going to bring in Gordon.
Vina, I want to ask about tenancy deposits, and Dan, I'll come to you first because you were the first to raise it. We heard in previous weeks evidence that cumulative since 2012, there are £4 million worth of unclaimed deposits in Scotland. I'm wondering if you could say something about the underlying reason for that and what we can do to minimise that amount of money lying unclaimed.
Mm-hmm. Well, it seems from the from what I read about this, it's a lot of it is seen as the result of students moving away, moving out of the country, and not claiming their deposit back. It is very concerning, though, if there's a much wider issue. I mean, ideally, international students should get their money back just as much as every other tenant. I think there is a real concern that tenants have, or a lack of understanding, lack of awareness of what their rights are around getting their deposit back. I think there are some landlords who don't make it easy. We hear from tenants it's one of the most common issues that comes up about landlords just making exaggerated claims at the end of the tenancy, really discouraging tenants from asking for their deposit back, from going through the deposit protection schemes, which may be contributing to this £4 million figure. What we'd like to see is some more responsibility on the landlord around the end of the deposit and end of the tenancy deposit return process. So there's actually a disincentive for landlords to exaggerate claims on the deposit, make it a much quicker process of going through the deposit protection scheme dispute process. Tenants should be encouraged to go directly there if their landlord hasn't responded or hasn't given it any indication of giving the money back, just so that process can be speeded up, and then you'll find hopefully tenants will have more trust in the system and more tenants will use it.
Okay. Who else wants to come in? Yeah,
I think Dan covered well as to why tenants don't claim back initially, but also the process is extremely long. So I moved into a new property in March, and my flatmate who moved in with me, so that's 3 months. He's only just gotten part of his deposit back, and you know, he's a member of Living Rent. He lives with me, he knows his rights. And it was a really extensive and arduous process that if you're not equipped or frankly have the patience to kind of meet letting agents and landlords with the legal jargon, then you're not going to get much back. So it's a really disincentivizing process. And I think we've seen that with things like rent adjudication or claims to the tribunal, that it's not an easy process for tenants to do. So in terms of perhaps equalizing it, that would be important, but also shortening the claim between either a letting agent or a landlord. I think with what we should do with that unclaimed money, that's a really fantastic question. And namely, tenants have paid into that system and it should be tenants who receive the benefit of that money. So that money could be used for legal aid services, for accessing the tribunal or to groups, not going to name names, who can like help tenants in these situations. It shouldn't be used to pay off landlords or something like that. So the main two keys are...
So you'd be supportive of the bill's proposal,
yes,
to support information services for tenant, private tenants?
Yeah, but not just information services. I think we get caught up on trying to make, put more and more information out there. And there's a lot of that already, but it's like actually... like helping tenants. There's a difference between information and helping, and it would be really fantastic to see that money go into specific housing legal aid to support tenants who, for example, don't speak English and need a lawyer. So we can use that money for information, but the most effective would be to actually support tenants through tribunal legal processes. So one, making the process of claiming deposits back easier for tenants, and then also supporting tenants through that process.
Okay. Anybody else want to come in? Yep.
Just quickly on that, yes, we totally welcome the use of the unclaimed deposits going towards advice and support, and we would echo that practical need for support, like one-on-one liaising officers, particularly for people who have additional complex needs, but also on terms of the process being off-putting. From personal experience, it's all online to claim your deposit back. It's done through emails, it's done through online portals, which many older people just don't know how to navigate, don't know how to access. They're perhaps inaccessible, they don't work with assistive technologies for a lot of people, so they just physically cannot navigate through that process. And then they go, well, it's £400, so I'm just going to have to live without it because I don't have the support and I don't know how to get around this, and there's no way of finding out that how you would go about that elsewhere. The information isn't available. So that's where the information piece comes in, but then having that practical support to help would also be extremely helpful for many people.
Okay, thanks very much.
Okay, thanks very much, Gordon. I think that brings us to the end. So thanks so much for the collective management of time there. That was good. Got us back on time. So thanks so much. It's been really helpful to hear your perspectives this morning. And as that was the final public item on our agenda today, I now close the public part of our meeting.